Hello, hello.
Good evening, everyone.
Hi, John. How are you?
Fine, Rondi. How are you?
How's your week, man?
Exciting. At the same time, looking forward to the weekend as well, even though there's not much of a weekend for me. I think it's the same for you, right, Rondi?
Yeah, yeah. You've been following up with all the political news and stuff.
Not really. Actually, more we follow. getting a little numb. To be honest.
I see.
Yeah.
Hi guys. Hi everyone. Hi Asbar, Vincent, Shafiq. If you guys can hear us, okay, maybe just type hello, say hi to John. I think this is his first borak session with us. Me and John, I only started to know John very recently only, right, John? I think this year alone. Yeah.
Last year, I think. Late last year. Was it? Oh. No. This year.
Yeah, this year when you invited me to the podcast. I think that was the first time we met. I think I met MJ before that. I think it has been quite an interesting time with you so far.
Yeah, exactly.
Looking forward to learn more and basically to work together going forward.
Yes, humble to meet you too, Ronnie.
Yeah, guys, if you have not subscribed to John and MJ YouTube channel, you can go to FIRL guys. They have a fantastic, one of the best YouTube channel in Malaysia when it comes to stock market lah, when it comes to Bursa Malaysia, in my opinion. They talk about the current happenings in Bursa, and not only that, they interview like really awesome people. Do check it out and subscribe to them. And of course, if you guys don't mind, just also subscribe to Stockbit Malaysia YouTube channel.
please do. Just subscribe. Stockbit. Yeah. We need to boost up the subscribership too, Rondi, for the YouTube on Stockbit.
Yeah. So, honestly, what we are trying to do here in Stockbit, it's exactly why we have this session as well. It's a free session, right? But our main mission and our purpose is really to just educate stock investors in Bursa Malaysia to have you guys understand better about businesses and to make better investing decisions lah, basically, right? So that's basically a little bit about us in Stockbit. Actually, if you guys want, there is a podcast of myself in FIRL's YouTube channel. You can check it out over there. We sort of like laid out about the plan for Stockbit going forward, right? There are a lot of things that is going to actually happening. So do stay tuned. And if you guys have not actually downloaded the app, please do so. And if let's say you guys do not want to have the app, you can actually just go to www.stockbit.com and register, sign up as a new user, and basically join the healthy and growing community there, lah. We will have like some features that is coming up soon. So just keep a lookout on that. John, do you want to sort of like introduce yourself?
Not much to say, actually. Just that maybe rather than introduce myself, I'd like to give a shout out to what you're doing, Rondi. The first time we met and after listening, and then when there was a slight break in the EMCO that time, we came out for breakfast, and then we went to an investor briefing, remember? You invited me. So I think what Stockbit and FIRL are trying to achieve are very, very similar in the sense that we're trying to elevate the Malaysian investor. And when we do that, ironically, it's actually helping both our communities grow. I see that as one objective. Secondly, is that helping make the markets slightly more efficient. I do not wish for the markets to be super efficient, Rondi, because both of us have no stocks to buy, but a little bit more efficient because I'm very saddened by the numerous people that I've managed to come across in my teachings and in my sharings and in my webinars that have lost so much money in the market because they either have been misled, either do not know particular skills to help them invest better. And actually, that's one of the reasons why, you know, MJ and I started Firal. And Rondi, we are supposed to do another podcast, remember, in October?
Yeah. Looking forward for that.
Yeah. So it's more important that we, the community that we are grooming, Rondi, I think it's more important. That's something that I will take instead of my introduction, take a bit of time to try to highlight, because through the course of what MJ and I have done, Rondi, we have managed to build an awesome research team. I know some of them are here. Obviously, yeah. I cannot divulge all their names. So to those, you guys know who you are, research team. I look forward to many more years working with you guys and, you know, to elevate the Malaysian investing community. So I think, you think we can start, Rondi?
Yeah, but I think, you know, John, it's, you know, before we start, do you want to sort of like explain to everybody, introduce yourself about your experience with Shell and stuff like that?
Oh, yeah. Okay. A quick one. So what I did was before I even graduated and I was doing my master's that time, I knew I didn't want to go and work in a factory because I used to work in a factory as a technician. Before I went to do my degree, and I ended up in Shell, very lucky, and I've been attached with what we call offshore projects for my entire career, and I spent 10 years there. I spent the first year in Holland, 6 months there. Then I was stationed in Miri, building what we call satellite jackets and wellhead platforms, and I'll explain. Oh, sorry. I actually started off with Sabah projects first. And I built, ironically, Hibiscus's platform, current platform. If you heard of this platform called South Furious. So I built Jacket E. That was the last new platform before Shell sold it off to Hibiscus. So that was my first foray into satellite jackets. Then I built platforms offshore Bintulu. In 2010, 2011, I was offshore for about 2 years. Was moved to KL, and I was helping Malampaya build a project in the Philippines. Came back to KL, built the first TLP in Malaysia, and that's when I left. So all in about 10 years, you know, I really enjoyed what I did, Rondi, but I was very tired with the traveling. And I wanted, you know, to spend more time with my family. My daughter's 12 when she was, can you imagine? She was 1.5 and 2. I was offshore. The longest spread I was offshore was 5 weeks, Rondi. I didn't come back for 5 weeks. Wow. Yeah.
That's intense, man.
Yeah. And I was, as a 29-year-old, I was leading the startup of a gas platform, a very big gas platform. Yeah, it still sends goosebumps to me whenever I think about those days. Because I virtually slept like 3-4 hours a day. But the thrill of, you know, what you've designed on paper 5 years ago come to fruition. I think that's what I really enjoyed. And Shell really trained me well. So, you know, kudos to them. Yeah.
All right. Okay, guys. So, you know, we have here an oil and gas, you know, experienced expert. So let's get the show going, John. It's all yours.
All right, thank you, Rondi. So chip in whenever you want to add some points, Rondi.
Yeah, let's make this like informal. So as and when I see some questions that is related to what you have just presented, I will just shoot it, guys. Yeah, so please. You know, just don't be shy. Ask John anything that you guys want when it comes to oil and gas related stocks in Malaysia, oil and gas industry, and everything. All right, let's go, right, John.
Yeah, so disclaimer, again, whatever stocks or case studies we're going to cover here, we're not licensed. We're not a licensed entity by the Securities Commission. So never buy and sell recommendation. This sharing is purely for educational purposes. Okay, no one reads the disclaimer. So that's why in small fonts, that's why I purposely put it very big. So these are the stocks that Rondi and I hold in between us. So, you know, there's no intention of fronting you guys. So there's a very clear, yeah, very clear show of what we're doing here is just for sharing purposes. So what are your key takeaways tonight? A lot of times people think that oil and gas industry is dead. And I'm going to do some myth busting to say that, okay, let's look at the facts, right? Secondly, we hope that you guys walk away understanding the industry value chain. There are certain instances where I will simplify, not oversimplify, I will simplify and draw analogies so that you guys can understand. But more importantly, it is for you to not memorize, but try to understand, right? The third thing, and I think it's very important, is to understand their business model and what these companies actually do. Learn to differentiate the operators, service providers, and revenue generation model for each. And last but not least, and I think this is something Rondi and I discussed prior to this as well, is understand the relationship between and sensitivity between crude oil prices and the profitability of some of these companies. Because a lot of people think, hey, oil price going up to from 50 to 70, how come, you know, oil and gas companies, the stock price is not moving? So we will be sharing some of these sensitivity relationships during this presentation. Okay. So myth busting number one, is oil and gas dead? I don't think it's dead. This is a projection done by EIA. And in 2050, in terms of energy consumption, natural gas will still be the highest in terms of British thermal units as a consumption for energy. Petroleum will be the second. As you know, a lot of people are into solar, renewable energy, hydro. It will still only make a fraction of what is needed for mankind in 2050. So when you hear people saying that we will go net zero and all that, it doesn't necessarily mean oil and gas is dead. They will have enough carbon offsets when they buy renewable energy to offset whatever they're harnessing from natural gas and petroleum to actually power the industry. Because as of today, if you look at the consumption that is growing, especially in countries like China and India, the demand is insatiable. And the only realistic and practical way forward is actually to make petroleum resources or enhance the energy from petroleum resources more sustainably rather than anything else. It wouldn't die. I don't think I will see oil and gas die during my lifetime. That's my prediction. But you know. Secondly, in terms of electricity generation, yes, there's a lot of hype going into EV, but natural gas and renewables, as you can see this chunk over here, natural gas will still be predominantly used for electricity generation. And these are not figures that I, you know, just pluck out thin air. This is EIA, right? The world's renowned energy standards or reference body that we always look to. If you look at renewable energy, yes, solar will definitely be what I call it, the pole position to actually generate electricity going forward, but it is still insufficient as compared to, you know, petroleum resources. That's undeniable. So oil and gas is definitely not dead. Not dead at least until 2050. Okay. The second highlight that I want to show is actually in terms of transportation. Motor gasoline, while transportation will switch over from motor gasoline to, you know, electric vehicles, their usage will actually go more into industrial. Today, industrial usage is not as prevalent for gasoline because it's expensive, but more and more petroleum resources will be diverted towards industrial usage. And a big chunk of it is actually petrochemicals. Today, just if you want to just take a look around you, whatever you're seated on your table or on your sofa enjoying this on the tablet, right? You cannot escape not using something that is from the petroleum industry in terms of plastic, in terms of, you know, probably even your remote control, probably even your mouse, you know, there's no way you can escape not having touch a petroleum resource, right? So this is something you added, Rondi. So maybe you want to share your thoughts on this.
Yeah, you know, like I just simply did a simple poll with regards to what the Stockbit community thinks is the reason on the lackluster of share price performance in the Malaysian oil and gas stock, as well as the sort of like the lack of interest, you know. And I simply give 1, 2, 3, 4 four reasons, right? Honestly, before I sort of look into the result, I actually thought, I mean, I personally voted it's ESG related, but to my surprise, right, it's actually the sustainability of oil price. And to me, that is very unique and it's interesting, right? And and some more like another one that is quite popular is the lack of understanding on the oil and gas industry. And I think both of these really show, I mean, they are related, I would say, right? Yes. Because if let's say we take a logical and a rational sort of like approach and think about which sort of oil and gas companies in Malaysia that is really directly related to oil prices, there is perhaps only one, right?
Correct.
But the, you know, the 30% of the voters here says it's the sustainability of oil price. So I just thought that this is quite interesting, and perhaps it is exactly why we will have this session. So let all of us to understand the business models of different companies, the supply chain, and the oil and gas sector a little better.
Yeah, that's right. And it's good that you brought up sustainability of oil price, because I'm pretty sure I repeat it somewhere, but because it is at this point, I think it's great. So I'll give a very quick overview of what does it mean by sustainability of oil price. So Rondi, would you want to take a guess, since you're not from the industry, how long before some what is the time frame between when an oil and gas field is discovered until it is actually producing crude? Do you want to take a guess?
Okay, I know that an oil field life cycle can range between 40 to 50 years. I think a lot of the Malaysian ones are around that age. But from the discovery until they make the first oil, a few years maybe, like three or 4 years?
Yeah, 3 or 4 years is actually very fast, really. Oh. It's actually very, very fast. Yeah, so that would be almost like an express. Maybe if you use a MOPU, which I'll describe later, maybe you can do that. But if it's a fixed platform or an FPSO, the FPSO alone to engineer and to construct will take you about 2.5 to 3 years already. So So why I'm asking you this, Rondi, is because all my life I've been in projects building facilities offshore. And the last project I was on, that project was shelved for 9 years before it saw a resurrection, you know, Rondi, because it was uneconomical. And why am I bringing this up to in relation to sustainability of oil prices? When oil prices are lower, no one wants to spend money. Okay, so when they are 30, 40, or even 50 US dollars, no one wants to spend money. And when no one wants to spend money, what happens? CapEx actually comes down, which we'll talk about when we discuss the Petronas CapEx. But regardless, any major oil company, E&P company, will reduce CapEx. And because of that, they delay what we call projects that are supposed to come on stream for the next few years. And what happens is that all these fields are finite resources, you know. The fields that are already producing have finite timelines and finite resources. So there is this term in the industry called assets replenishment or production replenishment. And that is actually seeing a decline. So what it means is your demand is going up. Your asset replenishment, production replenishment is declining. And yet people, if there's a low oil prices, people are spending less. CapEx is being spent less. So what happens if the demand suddenly has an upshoot and yet your production replenishment is going on a downtrend? There's going to be a gap.
Yeah.
And when that gap happens, you cannot fulfill it within a year or 6 months, you know. It doesn't happen that way. I mean, similarly, look at the semicon industry. That's exactly what happened. People were underspending CapEx. And then now it's catch-up time. And catch-up time in semicon is much faster than oil and gas, I can assure you that.
Interesting.
Yeah. So I hope you guys see this as a big picture, because in my 10-year career in Shell, I've worked on two projects that they actually shelved it. So we actually came up with the concept, written the paper, justified to the central office. Economics didn't make sense. They shelved the entire project. So So you see, there's so many variables in play, but I think it's good that you ran this poll because I hope the audience actually get to see in terms of, you just take common sense. When people spend less, capacity building is less. And then when the crunch comes and the demand comes, yeah. OPEC, Justin, I probably will explain it later, not now, because if not, just think of it as a cartel. You think of it as a cartel. It's like, okay, I'm simplifying here. So let's just say Rondi and I are the only guys who sell, okay, let's say cigarettes in Malaysia. Okay. What is it? Maybe candy. Okay, let's make it as chocolate in Malaysia, right? Yeah. And somehow Rondi and I became very greedy. And then what we do is someone else wants to enter the market. We say, hey, you better fall in line. You better join our gang. When you actually join our gang in a cartel, you in a way somewhat can price fix your oil prices by actually turning on the lever of your production. So OPEC is actually intended to do that because they want to try to sustain oil prices for the member states that they have. Mm. Yeah. Okay. That's a very brief explanation, Justin. I hope enough to answer you. Okay.
Yeah.
So the value chain of oil and gas, I would like to use and you know, I had a discussion with Viva T. I don't know if he's here. So, you know, we bantered on what would be the best way to. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. All right, Viva. So you know, you think of the oil and gas industry as a landowner and a land bank in the initial stage, all right? And the landowner is actually the state or the government of the day, right? And they actually possess this land bank that they want to develop, right? So as the landowner, Petronas, through its body called the Malaysian Petroleum Management, or MPM for short, they are the guys that have authority over these land banks, or what we call PSC blocks. PSC just stands for Production Sharing Contract Blocks. Okay. So what they do is, the struggle that they have as the landowner, if they want to develop all these blocks, right, they have to come up with a lot of money, lots and lots of money. And there's a lot of risk involved in developing all these PSC blocks. So what they do by de-risking is that, hey, can I invite different property developers to come and share this risk with me? Share not just the financial risk, but also the technical resources risk, and all these risks. They say, can I share this risk with the property developers, right? Mm-hmm. And these property developers, in exchange, what they do is they have to operate and maintain the asset, but in return, they have to clean up once they're done. Once you extract finish, you have to clean up. So these property developers, they also need help because they need specialist contractors to build or to give them services for certain things within the industry. So they need people to help them find oil. They need people to help them design and build facilities, right? We will discuss all these terms later, all right? They need help to install and commission the facilities, maintain and upkeep, right? And last but not least, store and transport. So this, I will cover the downstream as well, midstream and downstream as well. But for upstream and midstream, these are the specialist contractors that the property developers do. Okay. So now.
So this is extracted from the Hibiscus presentation, actually.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. And maybe you want to share some thoughts on it?
Yeah, sure. I think, you know, there has been quite a lot of images and infographics being sent around when it comes to Malaysian oil and gas value chain, who is in the upstream, downstream, midstream, and stuff like that. But yeah. I find this particularly easiest to understand.
Correct.
Because, you know, in Malaysia, there is just a lot of services players, service provider players, which is everyone is on the right side. And in terms of E&P, exploration and production, again, is just Hibiscus for now, I believe.
Yeah.
Maybe
yeah.
A little bit on Sapura and Reach. Is Reach still around? I don't think so.
They are still around, but their assets are mainly in Kazakhstan.
Yeah, okay. And yeah. Of course, midstream are guys like MISC doing transportation. and downstream are basically the people in the marketing. So like your Petronas Dagangan, Shell, Petron M, BHP, yeah. And yes. perhaps even some petrochemical players, right? Like your local right. chemical and PChem.
Yeah. So it's actually a good chart, simplified, but at the same time carries a good message. So like what Rondi pointed out, everything on the right are service providers to these players, actually. Yeah. Mm. So this is, okay, this is actually the model of the PSC. Now, it took me a few years to understand this as well. So bear with me and don't worry if you don't get it. Just get the key concepts is enough. So remember I mentioned about the landowners and then they're giving the leases of these land banks to the property developers, right, Rondi?
Yeah.
So how are they being compensated? So a lot of people think, oh, okay, today is $60 barrels of oil, right? Right? And yeah, how come Petronas is 60 or Hibiscus is $60 a barrel? Why don't their profit, if it goes to 80, why don't their profit just shoot up like that? There's a lot of components before they actually get to enjoy the honey, if you were to put it in. Yeah. So before anything else, the government extracts a royalty of 10%. So at $60 a barrel, this is a simplified calculation, mind you guys. So at $60 a barrel, royalty of 10%, government takes their first cut. They take the first 10%, right? Then whatever remaining here, there is actually what we call a cost recovery mechanism that the contractor actually can claim from the government. So why is that? You think about it, you are the landowner, you lease this land to the guys and you build the houses, right? But these developers are actually the asset still belongs to the state, you know. The asset doesn't belong to the property developers. So that's where it's very unique in PSC for your understanding. So Exxon, Shell, whoever PSC operator that comes in, they never own the asset. The asset still belongs to the state. So because the house is being built on the land that belongs to the state, the property developers or the operators can actually claim the cost from the state. This is what we mean by cost recovery. So maximum, they can claim up to 50%. So after you minus that off, let's say in this example, 33%, $18, right? The balance is 36. Now, once you get to 36, there is actually a profit oil split. So 40% belongs to the operator or the property developer. 60% belongs to the state again. So think of this as something like rental. So you got royalty. Now, on top of that, now the tax, when this article was written, the tax was actually 30%. Today, actually, PITA is at 38%. So net-net, you actually make about $4 for the operator on this example, $4. So it's not much. Yes, you recover your costs. Okay, this is a good thing because what Petronas is trying to say is you don't simply chin chai go and charge me. You go and build a gold-plated platform. You go and build a gold-plated platform. It functioning well and you can charge me for the cost, but then you get a share of this particular profit. Okay?
John, you know, maybe just a kindergarten question, right, for everybody
to know. No problem.
Perhaps maybe you would like to highlight the difference between a Malaysian oil field and what is PSC against, say, like an oil field in UK where, say, Hibiscus is operating. Hibiscus and even D-Nexus Ping, right? Yeah.
Yeah, Ping Petroleum.
Ping Petroleum, yeah.
Yeah, a great question, actually, Rondi. It's not a kindergarten question. So there are different countries around the world that have different systems to govern their oil and gas assets. In the US and also in the UK, they follow this system called a concession system. So concession system means this. Let's just say, you know, I was joking with Rondi, if he's a Texas cowboy and he owns a ranch in Houston, and then suddenly he wildcat a well, and then he found oil in his backyard. Actually, the mineral rights and the oil profit actually belongs to Rondi straight away. So that is, in a way, a concession system. So people can actually, let's say, Rondi said, I just want to rear my cattle. I don't want to do anything on oil. He can actually sell that rights of that concession to me. Let's say I'm an operator. He can sell it to me. And it belongs to me forever. Forever. So that differs greatly from a PSC regime, where the PSC regime, the mineral rights still belongs to the state. So let's just say, somehow or rather, by luck or by hook or by luck, your backyard in Miri somehow has oil. You cannot claim rights to it. It belongs to the state. And that's why this PSC structure. And I saw some good questions with regards to how did this come about. Actually, this came about based on the Petroleum Development Act 1974. So if you guys want to read up about how this came about and how PSC is actually governed, you guys can actually, you can download the Petroleum Development Act 1974. And I know I'm a Sarawakian. I saw someone putting a question. Ah, okay, this one. The Sarawak government is very powerful. They have asked for a larger share of the pie. How will it affect Petronas and other players? It's quite funny, you know, Rondi, because yeah. I have Sarawakians who are working in Petronas and they don't think Petros, which is the Sarawak state government setup of the oil and gas equivalent, they don't think they're ready. And these are Sarawakians, my classmates from, you know, 7 years old from Kuching. They don't think they're ready, right? Yeah. But for me, I look at it in a different way. They're never ready unless you give them a chance to be ready. Okay? And I think there's a lot of feeling of uneasiness because from the state of Sarawak, it doesn't seem that they are getting enough allocation to develop the state. And that's the reason why there is always been a push to actually take back more rights to actually the state. And actually, they are succeeding, actually, Rondi. All the gas, metered gas that in Sarawak are actually being taxed already by the state government, which wasn't happening before. So slowly and surely, they actually sent a team of, if you follow the news, they actually sent a team of the best lawyers from Sarawak to London to actually go and find the old ordinance, the mining ordinance of Sarawak, and to supersede the PDA, lah, which is the 1974 Petroleum Development Act. Lah. So I'm not going to go into politics and the history about it. It's a long, even if I chat until tonight also, I can't finish. But I feel that the state has its right to demand. I think there is, if the negotiations are done in a very fair manner, I think both parties should walk away amicably lah, to get something what they want. Lah. The state doesn't want everything. The state just wants, as a short state, just wants something more equivocal to them, being the biggest contributor of oil and gas revenues to the country. That's all. Yeah.
Okay. I think there are two, maybe let's just last question on this slide. Last two questions on this slide. So Kaizen, I think this is Max. Max is asking the 10% that you mentioned here, is it only applicable to export? And basically Bosch is asking, because of this entire PSC structure, is it fair to say that it is more profitable for oil and gas companies to drill and operate in the US and UK where they have the concession?
Yeah. I'll answer Max's question first. The 10% royalty, regardless of whether it's export or not, and I could be wrong on this, because whenever there is a foreign PSC that's operating, whatever profits is already going back to their home country. So that's why, regardless of whether the crude is for internal use or exports, the government wants to take a royalty on it. So my gut feel is that it doesn't differentiate between the crude is being exported or not, because most of the PSC partners are overseas partners. They're not local entities like Hibiscus, you see. Yeah, so that's my take. I could be wrong. I have to double check this, but I think regardless, royalty is just taken off. Okay. For the structure, whether it's fair or not, it really depends because it's not to say that once the PSC ends, let's just say Petronas gives a PSC to Shell for 25 years. It doesn't mean at 25 years, the PSC operator cannot ask for an extension. And in this case, like Hibiscus, I think when they bought over Repsol's asset, there's one PSC, if memory serves me correctly, 2027, which is like 6 years from now, or 2023. Yeah. One of it, I can't remember which one. So I don't think Petronas, if they feel that the contractor is a reliable contractor, when I say contractor means the operators are reliable contractors, they've managed to contain costs, they managed to give in good profit sharing, I'm pretty sure they would want to actually extend those PSCs unless they feel that, oh, this is too good to to give up to them or to give back to them extended PSE, they may want to take it back. And that is what has happened to the Shell assets in Miri, Rondi. The asset that I worked on, two of them have actually been handed back to Petronas already because they finished their 25-year gas PSE. Yeah.
Okay.
So can should I move on?
Let's go.
All right. Okay. So this slide is not meant for you to read. The whole
Let me
message
just make it bigger a little while.
Yeah. Okay. So the message of the slide is that we have a lot of companies in oil and gas. And the next slide, this is actually from MIDA and the Malaysian Petronas Resource Corporation. And yeah, there's a lot of players, but I have to reveal certain sad facts. The next slide. So this is the sad fact. This is actually done by the Prime Minister's Department and in collaboration with the Economic Planning Unit. What they did was they actually did a comparison, and I double-checked after our session this afternoon, Rondi. It's only for oil and gas service companies. It's not, so if you're operator, it doesn't include in this revenue.
Okay.
Yeah, it's purely services. Okay. Yeah. So
still, it's a lot of players for such a small amount of revenue.
Correct. Exactly. Yeah. So Norway, as a country that we all know for their wealth and so very good management of their sovereign wealth, they have about 1,200 companies in the oil and gas service sector, right? In contrast, Malaysia, with a smaller reservoir, smaller reserves, we have about 2,007 active and 4,000 companies. The rest are actually dormant, right? In the UK, it's roughly the same as the Norwegian, the Norway, 1,216 companies. Now, here's the numbers that I wanted to highlight. Out of these 2,700 companies, which is like almost more than double of the 2.5 times of Norway, the revenue generated by these service companies are actually half or less than half of those produced by the Norwegian companies. The reason for that is because a lot of the company revenue is generated on the lower end of the value chain. That means they are not charging, for the lack of a better word, premium revenue on services. They're on the lower end of the service value chain. And the UK, quite similarly to Norway. Now, here's the other sad thing, sad to say, even though I'm a Malaysian, it's actually sad, right? That a lot of these companies are based on an Altman Z-score. They're in greater financial distress as compared to the companies in Norway. So obviously, this is a generalized number because they take an aggregate of all these companies. But there are definitely gems that Rondi and I will discuss tonight within the industry. But on the average, most of Malaysian oil and gas service industry players are in not a very good financial shape. Okay.
Basically, they are eating a smaller pizza, but they have double the amount of people to feed.
Correct. Exactly. Spot on.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So the first part of the value chain is actually what we call the E&P operators or the property developers. So these are the guys. I could go on and on about the history of Standard Oil and how they broke up into 6 companies, but there's another time for it. So Malaysian players are Carigali. Okay, Carigali and Petronas they're related, but they perform different functions. A lot of people, get that mistaken. So the exploration and production arm for Petronas is Petronas Carigali. Okay,
It's not listed.
Yeah. So you've got Hibiscus Petroleum, who is listed. You got OMV, which is actually the guy that partnered with Sapura Energy for their E&P assets, and Newfield, which is also part of the Sapura Group. I don't know. I can't remember how much they sold off to OMV already. Memory serves me poorly on this one, but yeah, I think they sold off. Yeah. So what they do is operate and maintain the assets. They clean up, and you must clean up after you're done. So for key operational metrics for an E&P player, I think Hibiscus, kudos to, Lily, Dr. Kenneth and the team. I've not seen a more transparent IR reporting. I don't know about you, Rondi. I think you would not disagree with me on this.
yeah. It's good. It's very, very transparent.
Yeah, very, very transparent. I just wish Tan Sri Ngao would be of dialogue would be more transparent on his ENP, but the best excuse he always give me is that, oh, we're not the operator, we're just the joint venture partner. So he said that because we are not the operator, he cannot disclose. So it's a fair logical argument too, of him not disclosing. But coming back to Hibiscus, actually they just a few key parameters for you to understand. You think of them, they just need to maintain the asset with an highest average uptime as possible. So what does average uptime mean? The number over here, 95%. That means, let's just say out of 365 days, they were, okay, let's for simple arithmetic purposes, let's just say there's 100 days in a year and the average uptime is 95%. That means within that 100 days, within a year, they only shut down 5 days. So what you can do is at 95%, Randy, if you have a calculator, you want to help me calculate, you just say how many days in a year that they are shut down. Obviously, the higher the number, the better. And it is very, very unlikely for any ENP operator to operate 100% for a very simple reason. They need to shut down for what I call maintenance purposes. These are unavoidable. You must actually do it for technical integrity purposes. That's why you can never hit 100% uptime. It's very, very... So if you see anyone with 97, 98, you really have to take your hats off to them. That means they maintain the asset well. They don't, you know, they really take care of their houses properly. Right? The second number you look at is average gross oil production. Third number, average net oil production. Now, the gross and the net, the difference is, remember the PSC structure that I told you about?
Yep.
So the gross is actually what is total. The net is actually net to Hibiscus. They'll take their portion of the take, right? Mm. And the cargoes, if you can do some math, Rondi, I think one cargo is about 250,000 barrels, if memory serves me correctly. Yeah. So that's why you see here three cargoes is 870,000, give or take. So one cargo is roughly about 250,000 barrels of oil. Yeah, 250. Yeah, okay, to 300,000. So this is where they actually, when they say average realized oil price, this particular cargo, they managed to sell at this price. That's what they mean by average realized oil price. Because it fluctuates.
Yeah.
So some months is higher, some months is lower. For this particular two particular cargoes, this was the average selling price. And average OPEX per barrel is their cost to maintain and run and operate the platform. So I think I saw one of the questions with regards to OPEX just now. Let me see.
Got a lot of questions already.
Yeah, I already saw. It's like I'm trying to focus here because if I try to explain everything, I will be derailed. But
no, man. Go. Yeah.
So OPEX is, so if you think of what are the components of OPEX, their crew, the operation crew, the cost to maintain the platform, the cost to do audits on their platform, and what they actually also do is what we call production enhancement projects. So examples of production enhancement projects are actually like they will drill a well to actually do water injection. And when they do that, I'm simplifying here, when they do that, they are actually hoping to enhance the production of the well. Yeah. And this
we will talk about that later when we talk about RL actually.
Oh yeah,
which is exactly. Actually a supplier of Hibiscus as well.
Yeah, correct. So these projects and they have been very disciplined. Whatever projects they implement, they have a rule that the internal rate of return must be at 15%. And kudos to them. I think there's a very good rate to hit right? So they recently bought Repsol, and because of that, they actually increased what they call reserves. Now, I know some of you here are oil and gas experts, so bear with me while I explain to the rest who do not understand some of this jargon. So you think of 2P as what is in the tank. So when they bought this asset, there's an estimate of the probable reserves of what is in the ground, all right? And I'm not going to explain the whole 1P, 2P. You guys can go and just Google it. Just go Google 1P, 2P, 1C, 2C, right? But the number that is often used in the industry is this thing called 2P, right? 2P. It actually denotes the best estimates of the reserves, and it is the sum of proof plus probable reserves. So what does it mean? It means that this is very, very likely for hibiscus to actually extract from the ground. If you look at, there's another number which is a higher number, it's called the 2C reserves. Now, the 2C reserves is not to say that they cannot get it, but the probability of them getting is a little bit more difficult than the 2P. Okay? All right. Because of Repsol, they substantially improve a lot of their reserves. As you can see, it jumped 1.5 times. Including the gas, from a net oil kind of like a net oil kind of operator, because they bought Repsol, they almost became almost like a net gas, almost equivalent now, the gas production, right? And in terms of reserves, James actually asked a question, and I think it's a good one to answer before I move on, which is this. Why does OPEX per barrel vary greatly from quarter to quarter? Great question. Every quarter, there are certain kind of maintenance that need to be done. So in particular, let's just say at this quarter, let's say July to September, there was more maintenance work to be done. That's why it's being charged to that quarter. That's why the OPEX varies. Most of the costs, like your manpower, your crew change, your flight, helicopter flights and all that. I think in Sabah, they take boats. I don't know whether Hibiscus is kind enough to send them through helicopter. I don't know whether the helideck is still working. But when I used to work on the North Sabah fields, we take the boat. Right? So those don't really move the needle. But what really moves the needle are actually all those maintenance costs, your production enhancement projects, all those actually increase the OPEX. So James, I hope I answered you in that.
I think, you know, for Hibiscus, I mean, guys, if you have not watched the Hibiscus interview, please do so. It's still in stock. It's always going to be in Stockbit Malaysia, where John and Ming Tek actually interviewed Dr. Kenneth. If my memory serves me right, Dr. Kenneth did mention there is some seasonality when it comes to these OPEX and doing all this maintenance, and normally it's during the summer months when it is less choppy or something like that. So So those could be some of the times where you see that the expenses on this particular, I mean, on Hibiscus could be slightly higher than other times.
Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
Wow, there's a few more questions, but I think I should go on, because if not, I will never finish.
go. Okay.
Yeah.
We can take some of them later on.
We can take some of them. So sorry, guys, don't worry. I'll try to answer the simple ones. Yuli asked, can you explain layman what reserves actually mean? Yeah, just inventory. Very good. Just inventory. You think of it as inventory, correct? Okay. The 1P, 2P are actually the probability of how you're going to extract the inventory. The lower the number, that means the higher the probability. Just think of it that way. So 1P means it's much higher probability that you will extract everything. 2P is lower. The probability gets lower and lower. Yeah. Okay. Next. Okay. Hibiscus. Rondi.
Okay. Yeah. So, you know, I believe John mentioned in the beginning that one of the goals that we are trying to achieve today is to try and get everybody to understand the sort of like relationship and sensitivity of oil prices to the financial performance of different sort of like different counters in the Malaysian oil and gas sector, right? So I believe now we are in upstream, we're talking about Hibiscus. Now, what you guys can see here, right, is that there is the revenue and there is the net income. But if, let's say, we just look into the pattern, right? The pattern on, and this is basically per quarter, revenue per quarter from 2017 to recently quarter one of 2021. If you guys can see the pattern, the movements of the charts is actually very, very similar. So the financial performance of Hibiscus from 2017 to 2021 has actually a very, very similar pattern to oil prices, right? So they are basically positively correlated to oil prices. Their financial performance is positively correlated to oil prices. Of course, going forward, I would say maybe after the entire Repsol acquisition is done, you are going to be able to see that there's going to be a bump, right? after the acquisition is done. But after, like, let's just give them some time to sort of like stabilize for a little bit with the Repsol acquisition, you'll be able then to see the base. And again, most likely than not, their financial performance again will be related to the oil prices, oil price patterns again. Of course, if you guys again listening to the Hibiscus chat, they did mention sometimes, you know, there will be some sort of like a management call when they would like to say hedge the oil futures and stuff like that to sort of like stabilize on the volatility of oil prices. But more often than not, I believe that for Hibiscus, they are very, very, the financial performance and oil price is very, very linked.
Yep. Great. Next time you have to pinjam me your Bloomberg also. No, just kidding.
No problem.
Okay. So we come to one of the specialist services contractors in the very much needed in the oil and gas industry. And I don't know whether he's listening in. Sorry, I can't reveal his name. He's actually one of our coaching clients. He's actually on a seismic vessel, Randy. Offshore Brazil right now. So she's quite a beauty, the vessel. So when he was telling me he's on this vessel, I went to Google it. I said, wow, you know, it's a 60-man cabin. Most of the time when you go offshore, the cabin, you have to share the cabins. This one is a single-man cabin for each. So Mat Saleh level. Very rare. Very rare. Yeah. So seismic, what do they do? These are the guys that actually do what we call seismic data collection. They actually pull this thing. This is actually a seismic vessel. They actually pull this thing called streamers. If you can see this yellow thing over here, if you guys can see my circle, and they pull these streamers across the ocean, and these streamers actually shoot, you know, shock waves into the seafloor to try to detect the different layers within the subsurface and try to use that as data interpretation to know whether there's oil or not in the ocean. And it's been one of the most reliable ways to actually collect data from the subsurface. Now, if you guys remember MH370, company called Frugro. Yeah, Frugro was actually engaged to actually look for it.
I remember.
So, yes. So there's a lot of consolidation in the business, and Western Geco used to be a Schlumberger company, has now also been consolidated. So there's not many players here, actually. Same sort. Yeah, correct. Viva, I didn't read your comment. Yeah, because I always try to tease the audience about this. It's the same usage. So here's something more related to what we have in Malaysia. These are what we call drilling service contractors. So what they do is they actually own drilling rigs, and these rigs are actually leased to oil and gas operators. So like Shell, we don't build, or any E&P operator, we don't build our own rigs. We don't want to, because it is very heavy on the balance sheet, and we only use them when we need to explore for oil or when we need to drill what we call a producer. So most of the time we leave this, E&P operators like to leave this to specialists. And these are the different types of drilling rigs out there, okay? So this is actually a drill ship. As you can see, the reason why it's a ship is because it can drill to the deepest parts of the ocean, right? Then you have a semi-submersible. They can drill up to water depths of about 3,000 meters. If you guys want to watch a very good oil and gas primer, I highly suggest you guys watch Deepwater Horizon, and then Rondi has already watched it.
I watched it before this.
I would say about 80% of the movie is factually correct. About 80%, so it's quite well done. They got the facts right, right? Then you have what we call an ultra-harsh environmental jackup rig, and then you have a high-efficiency jackup rig. And these are usually used in water depths of about 100 meters only. And then you've got a drilling barge. They forgot to put in a semi. Okay, they consider this semi-submersible and a tender rig. So I'm going to talk about the Malaysian companies that are in this space. This is a drill ship. This is a semi-submersible. This is a jackup. This is actually in Singapore. This is about roughly about 100 meters. They jack it up just to test the jackup cans. And this is actually drilling in Nigeria, Randy. This is how they drill in Nigeria, actually.
Onshore, is it? So, is it onshore?
Yeah, this is no, they're it's onshore, but it's in the mud, it's in the lake.
Oh,
because they have a lot of swamp areas.
Mm.
So instead of like trying to, it's like half mud, half swamp, right? They just drill a channel where they can actually sail the rig in there.
Okay.
But very shallow. It's yeah, swamp land. Okay. The viscosity of Nigerian crude is very thick. African crude is very thick. You think of it like our Malaysian crude is like very diluted honey, whereas in Nigeria is very thick. You know, in Ghana, if I'm not mistaken, one of the highest viscosity one, you take a beaker, right? You overturn the beaker, the oil won't even come out, you know, Rondi.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah. So the what Malaysian crude, very light, very sweet. So you pour it out, it's like kerosene kind of thing. But if you go over to countries like Africa, high viscosity, a lot of wax, you turn the beaker upside down, it wouldn't even come out. So yeah. So these are the guys that actually are what we call rig owners in Malaysia. You've got the guys like Sapura, you've got the guys like Velesto, and you've got the guys like Perisai. Now, if you guys have been, I hope none of you here are invested in Perisai because their one and only rig actually sank. Yeah, it's quite sad. Their one and only rig actually sank. They financially have not been doing too well as well. So the big boys in this space are actually guys like Transocean and Valaris. So rigs can actually be generally demarcated into offshore rigs, and Transocean is operating one of the world's largest offshore rig fleets in the world. And then you've got land rigs, and these are mainly to serve the shale industry in the US and in China, right? The shale industry especially. So their business model is very simple. They don't care about oil price, because oil price go up or down, not to say they don't care, but it's not directly correlated like what Rondi explained in Hibiscus, because their revenue model is based on a leasing structure to the oil and gas, the E&P operators. Obviously, when oil prices are low, the E&P operators will not have that much development budget. When we say development means well exploration, all those development budget, it will come down. And because of that, the rig lease or demand for rig lease will come down. So it's not a direct correlation. It's an indirect correlation, but it's not directly correlated to oil price. I hope you guys are clear on that. Okay. Now, this is a second myth I like to bust, and this is a joke that even Dr. Kenneth and I, or even a lot of the oil and gas players like Yinsen, we keep on joking. Please educate people outside the industry. There's a difference in between a drilling rig and a production facility. A rig is not a facility, and a facility is not a rig. Okay, all right. So a rig, the purpose of a rig is to drill. To drill a well, whether it is an exploration well or a production well, it is to drill a well. Its sole purpose is to do that. It is not meant to be there when the field is producing. So if I were to give you a timeline, they will go to a platform like this, a newly built platform like this. They will actually drill, find the well, right? Find the oil, drill the well, find the oil. They will complete the well. And we will talk more about completions when we talk about reservoir link later. And they will go away. They will just go away. So if you can see the red box over here, this is actually the production facility. You know, this is actually what we call a satellite, a wellhead satellite jacket. It's a very small wellhead platform. Look, this is how it looks like without the rig. Okay. And this is actually what we call usually call a central processing platform. This is where all the let me show you in another photo later what I mean by central processing platform. But just make sure you guys, please, it will be a disservice that you guys leave this session, don't know what's the difference between a rig and a platform. I will shoot myself. Right. So rig to drill, platform for production facility to produce. Okay. Now, this is where we're going to talk about okay, I just want to make sure everyone's I've not lost everyone yet. Everyone's still okay? Still alive? Can you guys give me a one or something?
Guys, if you've been enjoying what John has been sharing, please press the like button, please press the heart button, you know. It's not every day that we can have this privilege to have like an oil and gas expert to explain to us about the difference between a rig and a production facility.
Thanks for your kind words, Randy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I know you guys have a lot of questions. We will try to answer them at the end. The reason why we don't take them now is because I'm scared I can't finish. There's a lot of slides. I'm only at slide 28 of 80. So, yeah. Okay. Next, we come to drilling services. So, remember the owners of the rig, they also need contractors to help them in the drilling process. Okay. So, in drilling services, what do they do? There's many, many things that happen while the drilling process is. If you've worked in the oil and gas industry, there's actually a job called a mud engineer. I kid you not. M-U-D, mud engineer. His job is to make sure that there is enough pressure in the mud to keep the well from collapsing. And he's a very highly paid guy. So I don't know, Rondi, if you remember. In the movie, right? They got the mud wrong. They stopped the mud and then that's it. Right. So oil and gas service, oil field service contractors, especially in drilling services, they provide a myriad of services. Now, I can name a few and I'm going to let Rondi explain about Reservoir Link. So in general, they actually provide drilling equipment and services to drilling rigs and E&P operators. So one very big service that they normally provide is what we call a wireline service. So wireline service is like, once you've drilled the well, you want to check whether there's anything wrong with the well, or you want to see which sections of the well, let's say, is actually stuck. You actually send in a wireline, right? You send in a wireline. So most of the time, it's a very expensive wireline. You actually have fiber optic cables going down, and there's a camera. So it's very, very expensive. So you think of it, there's nothing else for you to see. You know, it's not like a see-through glass. You can see everything underneath, you know. So what they do, they come out with ingenious engineering methods. And one of it is actually to send a fiber optic camera down the wire line to actually check on the well bore. And that's one of the services. The other services are mud, directional drilling, drilling fluids. They call them drilling fluids. The other term for it is actually a mud, okay? I work on a rig and I'm a mud engineer, but highly paid. I doubt that. Coco said highly. better tell your boss you're underpaid, Coco. All right. So hopefully you're with Halliburton or Schlumberger, or you know, they really work you, okay? Okay. So Rondi, to you on Reservoir.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, maybe John, if you don't mind going up one slide.
Yeah.
Yeah. So over here we can see some of actually Reservoir Link's I would say peers, right? There is basically Dilium and Uzma. Yeah. So basically what Reservoir Link is doing is that they are an oil field services company. That is, can you go down one slide, John?
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So they specialize in providing well services. Just now, as what John mentioned, once you dig, once you drill, right, and then you found a well, and then there are like a lot of services in relation to the well. So there is this term which was new to me, and it is basically well perforation. Well perforation is basically when just now John mentioned there is like all this strict line and all that, and there is the term where they call as a perforation gun, if I'm not mistaken, right, John?
Yeah, correct.
So
correct.
So they do that to actually perforate, they do perf on the well, and correct. This is where they sort of like look out for the oil to be pumped out, and so you know, just to discover the oil, I would say. Sorry, John. Go back one.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to add on to what you said. So what they do, actually perforation is a very sexy word for explosion.
Yeah. They're basically a dynamite expert.
Yeah, dynamite expert. So Coco, him or her being a mud engineer, they'll definitely know a perf guy. So what they do is they'll send a gun, a perf gun like what Ronnie said. It's actually filled with dynamite. And let's just say if you guys see my mouse here, right? So let's just say this particular section has oil, this particular section doesn't have oil, and this particular section have oil. Because the well is actually completed and is cased in, they actually need to create tiny holes so that the oil can actually flow into the well bore. And they do that by actually doing perf, lah, perf at certain segments of the reservoir to allow oil or gas to actually seep through those holes into the well bore. So this centerpiece here is called the well bore. Outside, you think of it as many layers of skin. Lah. The well has many layers of skin. And the perforation is to channel holes and to allow channels to actually channel of holes to actually allow the fluid to actually come in and to up to the well bore. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah. Anything else to add here, Rondi, if you want to add anything else?
So this is basically just a slight explanation about what Reservoir Link is doing. If you guys can see on the financials, they do a lot about well perforations. There is basically a part over there which actually talks about wash and cement. So I think that is the sort of business that RL is doing when it comes to a well that is already being decommissioned. So maybe you just go to the next slide, John, right? So if you guys, I'm not sure if you guys can see clearly here on the bottom left. On the bottom left, it's actually the oil field life cycle, right?
Yeah.
And I borrowed this from Hibiscus. Maybe let me just make it bigger.
Zoom already quite deep.
All right. So the good thing about what this RL is doing is that, okay, currently they actually are doing some jobs in Africa for Petronas. What's the name of the country?
Mauritania.
Mauritania, yeah. So yeah, on that particular job, you can see that Petronas is basically having an end life cycle for the wells over there, and they are basically doing the wash and cement, lah, right? So the good thing about RL is that they will be doing well perforation, and well perforation is being done in all life cycle. I mean, throughout the life cycle of an oil field, I would say, right?
Correct.
So, you know, sometimes even in the Malaysian sort of like oil field, I think when we spoke to the management, they did mention a lot of the Malaysian oil field are quite old. They are like
almost about end 20, of life already.
Yeah, 20 years old, 30 years old. And during that time, you know, they did like the seismic, it was just 2D back then or something like that, right?
Correct.
So what they did is they need to re-perf, or maybe they need to add perf to actually get more oil out of that particular well. So RL does that. They perf on production well. And of course, well has a lot of layers. That is exactly why they are doing it. Over the years, you know, some well might have water, right? And then you have to add perforation job again.
Yes.
Right? And basically, even sometimes some of the well, some of the well got stuck or blocked, and then you have to again do a reperf.
Correct.
So that is exactly how RL is getting their jobs, I would say. And of course, it's on a job and activity basis, I would say. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong there.
No, you're absolutely right. It's really on an activity basis, and doesn't mean, and I think it's very related what you said to Zafiro's question. It doesn't mean that it's only during the expansion phase, because a lot of end-of-life wells, what they need to do is they need to re-perf because if you recall what Rondi said earlier, certain segments are blocked. And then certain segments have actually, there's no water aquifer pressure to actually drive up the oil and gas or the condensate anymore. What they do is they re-perf other segments of the well through a slick line so that those new segments or those new segments of the reservoir can actually produce. It's not just during greenfield, it's actually more during brownfield as well. But it's mainly for oil, you don't actually reaper for gas wells actually, mainly for oil. Yeah.
And, you know, basically, just give me 1 second because I can't really see the... If let's say you guys look into like at the tail end over there where I actually draw
cement here, is it?
Yeah. So before one of the big down sort of like gray bar at the end, right? there is basically a slight spike on a yellow bar. So yeah. I think what that is showcasing is that there are some sort of like perforation job that is being done on late life asset. So you know, during times when especially when oil price are higher, right? There are some oils that are basically stuck in stones or some rocks or something like that. So they do like an EOR. They extract oil out from the rocks, and they do like one last grab on the final oil and stuff like that, like
final squeeze.
Final squeeze,
hit the final squeeze.
Correct.
Yes.
And what I would like to mention also is that on the right side over there, so on the right side, on the bottom right, this is actually Petronas's CAPEX or Petronas's outlook in the next 3 years when it comes to decommissioning. And if you guys can see, this is, I would say, one of the interesting part, right? Because later on, you guys can see on Petronas's outlook on a lot of different segments of the businesses and the streams. But on the decommissioning part, it is actually on an upward trend in a sense that in the future, there is going to be some decommissioning job that has to be done. And I think that reservoir link could be at the good spot, lah. You know, I would think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Very well managed company in terms of finances as well, I would add to sum it up. Yeah.
Yeah.
So next. Yeah, this one also your sensitivity.
Okay. So coming back again to the sensitivity of oil price against the financial performance of a particular company. So if you guys can see, you know, from ever since 2017, the oil price have been quite choppy, up, down, up, down, up, down. But if you see the financial performance of Reservoir Link, it has always been like a one line going up. So what I would try to conclude, I might not be 100% correct on this because there could be some other things that is going on behind the scene. But what we can see is that despite the downtrend in oil price from end 2018 to 2020, right, RL managed to record higher revenue and higher profit. So indicating that there could be a low direct correlation between oil price and the financial performance of Reservoir Link. Of course, a lot of people then will ask, what happened in Q1 2021? Yeah. So as what we saw in the QR report and all that, although that the oil price had recovered, again, RL is actually at the sort of like a bad shape in Q1, right? Although the oil price had recovered. But RL recorded a very weak quarter due to, again, lack of activity and some job delay. What we are trying to highlight here is that this sort of company, like Reservoir Link, it is not really dependent on the prices of oil, but on activities, right?
Correct, correct, exactly. It's I wouldn't say it's negatively correlated. There's somewhat of a correlation because the prices of oil reduces the activity, but it's not a direct correlation. I think that's the point that Randy is trying to bring across. Okay. Anything else, Randy?
I think you can move maybe, but you just try and help me understand here, right, John? So, let's just assume that just now we mentioned about Petronas's outlook on decommissioning of well in 2022 is on the up, but let's just say that oil price is on the down, right?
Okay.
But what is going to happen is that there could be some sort of activities because you need to wash and cement these places, right?
Precisely.
So, what is unique then is that Reservoir Link could be at the place where there is actually going to be a lot of activities sent to them, being given to them, while oil prices is low, and actually their financial performance could be good. I'm just throwing an idea here, you know.
Yeah, you know, this is right. That's why. Too bad you can't see my circle. I just use the mouse to circle here.
Yeah.
Because I'm circling here, but I don't know how it doesn't show on stream here. But nevertheless, what you're trying to say, maybe I crystallize it another way, is this. This is a job not many people want to do, because this is the dirty, the three D's of the job: dirty, I can't remember the two other abbreviations, but you get me, like, this is a janitor's job. No one wants to do it because it's not sexy. Right? People want to do wireline, people like to do take calls. As a well engineer, that's the things that you strive for, right? But no one wants to do a wash and cement. You don't grow up in a well engineering fraternity and say, hey, I want to do wash and cement. it's not a dream job. So when people don't want to do the job, that's why when you are willing to do the job, that's why you make money. Dirty, dangerous, and difficult. Correct. Yes. Correct. Thank you. Yeah, DDD. Right. So I'll move on to offshore production facility. Okay.
Yes.
And first, I'm just going to give you a brief overview on the different types of production facility. If you want, you can go Google it. There's a lot of resources online. My aim here is not to spoon feed you guys everything, you know, because if I spoon feed you guys until tomorrow also, I cannot finish. But what I hope to give is I give you a teaser so you know where to start reading and to start researching. Okay. Yeah. So anyone here, and I do this every time, especially to Malaysian guests, anyone here want to take a guess around Malaysia, what is the water depth, average water depth of South China Sea, actually? Rondi? You remember your geography, or not?
Bro, I think I failed my geography, man.
Anyone, please answer us. Type in a number for me, please.
As a matter of fact, I was very, very bad in science, lah. You know, biology, physics, chemistry, everything. I was just a C student.
Yeah. Ivan said 10 to 20 meters. Not so shallow, lah. Not so shallow. James, almost there. On average, the South China Sea water depth is between 60 to 150 meters. Yes, 100 meters. Now, why is this important? It's because when you understand the water depth within this region, you will understand the type of offshore production facilities that will be built predominantly in this area. So if you go to Gulf of Mexico, the average water depth is very deep. Like if you watch Deep Water Horizon, the well was actually about 10 kilometers deep. so they deal with a lot more deep water assets compared to Malaysia. Malaysia has only very few deep water assets. And I worked on this, the first TLP in Malaysia, actually, before I left Shell. We have a lot of fixed platform. So this is what we call a steel jacket, a jacket structure. And the red part here is called a topside. Okay, so this is a production facility. The yellow is a jacket. The red part is called a top side. So in Malaysia, it's very cheap to build this. And because of the geographical condition, it's 100 meters, right? It's easy to build this kind of structure. Very, very... the technology is not that difficult. Obviously, as you get deeper and deeper, that's where you get a lot of these more complex deep water type systems. And that's where FPSO is actually very predominant, especially in Brazil, because they have a lot of deep water assets, actually. So this was the platform I actually built, Rondi, in the middle of my career. This was the one that I spent 5 weeks. So this platform was like my second home. It's like my second home. So you see, this is where the drilling actually happened. You know, if you can see my mouse circling over here, this was actually the drilling platform. This was where the wells were. And you see there's a bridge here. There's actually a safety reason why this was designed this way. So that if the well explodes, there's actually a physical separation. That's why they are designed this way. This is the central processing platform. This is where the oil and gas is separated. This was actually the compressor platform where we actually had the gas that was dehydrated here, and it actually gets compressed here, and is from here it was sent 200 kilometers to Bintulu. So there's actually a pipeline here, 200 meters all the way to 200 kilometers, not meters, 200 kilometers away to Bintulu. And this was the latest. This has been around for about 20 years. My project was to build this. This was the new platform, and there's another platform that's about 32 kilometers. Oh no, this direction, 32 kilometers away this way. So that was a satellite jacket that tied to this processing platform, the central processing platform. Yeah. This is actually Malikai, the first TLP in Malaysia. This was my last project before I left. It's offshore Sabah, 1.3 kilometer water depth. I can't remember what was the depth of the wells already. Yeah, but this only in Sabah you get actually deep water fields. This is actually also in Sabah. This is a TLP. It's called Tension Leg Platform. This is actually a trust spa. So it's just a single, it's like a single cylinder that actually is buoyant in the ocean and is actually secured by cable lines. Strong cable lines. Yeah, and this is actually in Sabah, right? Mm. So for you to build this, you actually have to go through the what we call an EPCC cycle. And this phrase gets thrown a lot, especially when you have a company like Serba, your company like Sapura Energy. Everyone claims they want to be an EPCC contractor. So what does EPCC actually mean? It stands for Engineering, Procurement, Construction and Commissioning. Now, it sounds very sexy, but if you were to draw parallels to the construction world onshore, it's like your turnkey contractor to build your house. So instead of going to the guy who builds your plumbing, the guys who build your electricity, the guys who build your concrete, it's one guy, one contractor doing everything.
Yeah.
Pao kao liao lah. In Hokkien, we say pao kao liao lah. So these are pao kao liao contractors in the oil and gas world.
Yeah.
So in Malaysia, we have these guys, MISC, Muhibah, Sapura Energy, MMHC, Dialog. Now, they are EPCC contractors, but they're also sub-niches in EPCC contracting. So like Dialog, they don't do upstream EPCC work. They mainly do midstream EPCC work. Midstream and downstream. Refinery plants, petrochemical plants, storage facilities. MISC do a lot of FPSO conversion, topsides, building. Muhibah does a lot of skids. Sapura does a lot of topside facilities, platforms as well. And the global competitors that they're competing against are these guys are big. Okay, you talk about Technip, Chiyoda. Chiyoda's Japanese. KBR, Kellogg Brown and Root, one of the largest oil and gas engineering companies in the world. Actually, they benefited a lot during the war. Yeah. So Flo is also if I'm not mistaken, they're US based. I worked with them when I was doing the Malampaya project in Manila. Yeah. So you actually need these guys to engineer, procure, construct, and commission. And when you construct, you need a special facility called a fabrication yard. So what does a fabrication yard do? They actually weld the steel, they actually assemble all the big parts. And this is actually MMHC yard. It's actually one of the biggest yards in Malaysia. And this is actually the Sapura Lumut yard. So Lumut, the yard is quite big actually, Rondi. One day, you know, if you can drive up to Penang, we can detour, I can bring you here.
Sure.
A lot of friends here. Yeah. Just to let you have a look at how a yard is actually run. And for those of you who are outside the industry, actually these yard licenses are actually granted by Petronas. Not every Tom, Dick and Harry can open a yard. So these licenses are very special. And if you have been in the oil and gas, if you've been investing in oil and gas companies, there was a big hype during 2007, 2008 about, was it like Tabung Haji? And they actually fried up the share price, you know, Rondi, because they were rumored to get the yacht license.
Okay.
So the moment they thought that the moment they get licensed, that's it, you know, profit is going to jump, whatever. But that wasn't really the case. It was a very nice goreng stock at that time. Yeah. So Brook Dock Yard is in Kuching. KKB Kokap Bank also has a yard in Kuching. Boosted is actually in Lumut because they actually do a lot of the Navy ships. So a lot of the Navy ship contracts actually get sent to Boosted. Labuan Shipyard obviously in Labuan, and Muhibah, I can't remember where they are. I've never been to the Muhibah yet. But I think it's in Selangor or Port Klang. I may be mistaken. I have to double check on that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So once you've built it in the yard, you now need to install it offshore. And this is where our Malaysian champion is actually Sapura. So think of these guys like Lego blocks, and they actually need to lift a very heavy piece of Lego block into place to install them. So this is actually the top side, and it will be mated to the jacket that is already piled into the sea. They're lifting, these assets are actually judged by what we call lifting capacity. So the heavier you lift, obviously the better you are. And obviously the more expensive you are. So just to give you an indication, my second last project I built, we actually hired a McDermott lift barge. the rate was about $1.3 million a day, Rondi, one day. So if it's raining, that's $1.3 million gone.
Crazy.
Yeah. So time is very critical. Time is very critical for this. They usually come during a 7 or 14 day window. They try to get their work done as fast as possible and get out. We also want them to get out because they're very expensive. Very, very expensive, right? This is one of the largest in the world. This is the Splenier, owned by Herama Marine Contractors. They're one of the largest marine contractors in the world, a Dutch company. And this is all seas. This is the largest one of its kind in the world right now, 26,000 tons. Yeah. So you'd be asking me, you know, when we talk about hibiscus, there's a big part of decommissioning work that needs to be done by hibiscus, Rondi. Do you remember Dr. Kenneth mentioned this? Decom? Decommission. Where they have to restore the platform back to original state?
Is it? But none of their wells are at that stage yet, right?
No, none. But when it reaches that stage,
yes. Of course, yeah.
Yes. So these are the same guys that they will need to hire, Rondi.
Okay.
So you hire them to build. You also hire them to demolish because only their cranes can actually lift the top side. Because you cannot, even if you chop it up into smaller pieces, you still need a heavy lift barge to actually lift the thing. So you actually hire the same guys for decom work also actually.
Yeah, actually that's the decommissioning part, right? It's very, very interesting, you know, because if let's say we talk about, I don't know, owning a solar farm or something like that, right? There is no such thing as a decommissioning work, but if let's say we're talking about oil production and stuff like that, your calculation on, you know, the lifeline of your sort of tenor, it has to end with a decommissioning work.
Correct.
So it's a bit funny because if let's say you would like to do like a discounted cash flow, you need to find the end and you need to sort of like discount that into present value and stuff like that. It's interesting. The pricing of decommissioning then can be different, totally different than whatever it is.
Very different because
inflation adjusted and all that, right? So I have no idea how to do that, like, honestly.
Yeah. So for those of the audience who want to actually watch, we won't show it here. You just type this thing called brand decommissioning. So this is one of the largest platforms in offshore North Sea, UK. And they actually use this particular barge, the Allseas, to actually lift it 25,000 tons. 25,000 tons. So they only had 1,000 ton extra margin. So it was lifted in 9 seconds. So if you guys want to see how decom actually works, this is how it works. Go watch the video. It's about 11 minutes, okay? So moving on. So at this point, do you guys want to take a quick break? Or do you guys okay to continue?
Yeah.
It's about 1.5 hours into it. We're only halfway through, Rondi. So
I mean, John, I'm not really talking, you know, so I don't know how you can do it. And somehow I have my water here.
Brand decommissioning, yes, Ivan. Okay, I think I'll just continue. And you know, allow me to actually talk a little bit about what we have to offer at Firal. You know, when you come to listen to a lot of these talks and we give you industry business models, mental models to think about, to understand the business, right? I'm pretty sure some of you can actually you know, relate to these questions I'm about to ask you, you know. So you see, hey, how come John or Rondi or whoever that's presenting all these businesses, on how do they actually conduct primary research? How do you do valuations? Like what Rondi said about decom costs, how do you do a discounted cash flow model and then you have to park in the decom rates? Actually, Rondi, I can show you offline later. It's a little bit long-winded, but I can show you. Yeah. So,
no, I was just thinking there will be a lot of assumptions.
Definitely. Actually, that was the question I asked them, if you remember that time during the hibiscus. Not during the live one, but during their analyst briefing. So, how do you do valuations? How do you assess quality of management? Now, quality is subjective, but ironically, you can actually quantify quality of management, right? You can actually quantify quality of management. And then how do you look for industry trends? How do you, let's just say you want to invest in oil and gas, or you want to invest in semicon, and you want to invest in textile. How do you actually search for, how do you do primary research and look for industry trends? Then next, are you actually good at, once you've done all your valuations, your stock pick, understand the trends, are you actually good at portfolio management and construction? So this part is usually very underrated. Most people out there don't actually showcase or show how to do it in a professional manner. Yeah, portfolio construction and management, very, very key to managing your money. And last but not least, how do you reduce your probability of losses? Now, for those of you who can attest or relate to these questions, can you guys give me a one, please? Just give me a one in the chat. Yeah, I want to take a break for water too. The chats are pretty slow coming in.
Yeah, there's normally that lag.
Yeah, okay. No, normally that, yeah, okay. Elbow cough. Yeah, so one of the reasons why MJ and I, we started this was that on top of giving talks like this to understand, business models, business revenue generation and all that, we also knew that there is a skill discrepancy and a gap in which you need to understand what we are trying to say or understand the financials of these companies. Last but not least, most of us struggle with timeline. Pretty sure you and me, Rondi, we have kids, right? You know, we pull in all directions. Yeah. Right? Yeah, we pull in all directions. Even when you sit down and read an annual report, also sometimes you get a lot of distraction, right? So that's why we created this stock investing blueprint. It's actually a course designed to actually answer all those questions that I posed, because that was the struggle that I had when I started investing. And as an engineer, I was offshore most of the time. I didn't have enough time. I didn't have enough structure to understand or to evaluate businesses. And this is something that MJ and I created from a combined 20 years of investing experience. We want to shortcut the learning. Not shortcut the research, but shortcut the learning for you guys to understand or to value business in a structured manner. So in this particular curricula, we have, we show you what to buy, when to buy, a portfolio management, how to start a step-by-step. We even teach you how to use financial data providers like Share Investor. Hopefully Stockbit can get theirs up and running as soon as possible. Don't make sure you don't charge us a premium, Rondi, to use your financial data. Don't charge us Bloomberg prices.
No. Definitely right. Not. Definitely not. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So then we have a Q&A. We do a Q&A every month because there's a lot of questions like these sessions. And in a Q&A sessions, there's a no holds bar. We get updated every month. And you can actually find them here at our website, our e-learning website. It's called learn.fira.co. Mm. And on top of that, for those industry veterans, they are, John, I'm an expert in analyzing financial statements. I'm an expert in reading AR reports and all that. And you want an industry trend. You want an industry research done for you. We also have that. And we call these the industry deep dives. So most recently, I think Ashwin, I know a few guys here, Ashwin, these guys, they've joined in our industry deep dives before. The last one we did was actually on retail. I don't know, Ashwin, huh? Did you enjoy it or not? Hopefully you don't throw tomatoes at me. Yeah. So we have them all there. Go check out our website, And hopefully you can pick up a thing or two from there, lah. Yeah. Mm. So we go on to
I think maybe just let me give a little bit of feedback, lah. Because I'm sort of a neutral party. I'm not really in. I've been to one of John's deep dive, even the oil and gas. But nowadays if let's say you're a beginner in the stock market and you're looking for some sort of guidance and some sort of, I would say like stock market guru or teacher or something like that, right? To get you to kickstart, I believe like one of the sort of characteristics that you need to look into is basically the desire of that said person to really learn, and the desire to be proactive, the desire to keep improving themselves, right? And you guys would have been, if let's say you guys are subscribing to Firal's YouTube channel, you guys would see that they are on a weekly basis, they would be interviewing like really, really industry veterans, industry experts, right? So you really can see that their desire and their passion for the subject matter is real. And I just would like to add that lah. Yeah, I mean, I know John, I know MJ, and I believe that they're a real learner of investment. And I think if, let's say, you guys are trying to kickstart with them, I definitely wouldn't say that it is a bad move. I would say that it's definitely a good move.
Okay, thanks so much for your kind words. I have to pay you for that. Which I didn't.
No.
I'm just kidding. I know. I'm just kidding. Right. So let's move on. Next is production facilities for hire. So think of this like instead of you buying a house on a piece of land, you are like trying to buy a container hotel or container house. You know those container houses that they have in Japan and all that. Yeah. So this is where the FPSOs and the MOPUs actually come in. So let me explain what are FPSOs and MOPUs first. So FPSO stands for a floating production, storage, and offloading facility. It is actually the functional terms of a vessel or usually an oil tanker that is actually converted to be a floating platform offshore. So that's why it looks like a ship. It virtually is a ship. It's a tanker. And what they do is they strip out the top of the tanker and they actually put in modules to actually process oil and to actually store oil in the hull so that they can actually offload it to either a shuttle tanker or to a pipe. Usually it's to a shuttle tanker and the shuttle tanker actually takes it to shore. And these are normally tied down to the seabed with what we call subsea wellheads. So if you can see in my picture here, I'm circling through the mouse. These are actually the wells. The wells are actually not on the surface. So like, if you remember earlier when I showed you the production facility, those are actually surface wells where the well head is actually on the surface. In this case, normally for an FPSO, the well head is actually at the bottom of the sea. And these are what we call subsea completion, subsea well heads. And they tie back through flexible pipes all the way to your FPSO. So this is how it looks like, all right? These are the players listed in Malaysia. Even though they're listed in Malaysia, Yinsen only had their first FPSO in Malaysia just last year, you know, Rondi. I don't even remember. FPSO Helang was the first one.
Not last year. I think about this year, few years
back. Helang was when? Helang was just quite recently, only.
I mean, Helang is recent, but I think their first FPSO would be...
No. The first Vietnam. FPSO in Malaysia...
In Malaysia.
All right. Yeah. So MISC, Bumi Armada are the other FPSO players in the market lah. Now, Rondi, yours, sensitivity.
Okay. So coming again to this part, and this would be the last example that we are going to give, you know, and with regards to sensitivity of a company towards oil price. If you guys can see here for Yinsen, right, it's very funny because in terms of revenue, suddenly there's a big spike here and there. But when you look into the net profit, it does sort of move perhaps a little bit in tandem with the oil price, but sometimes they are still very, very resilient against some oil prices that has been going down. For instance, in 2020, they are still resilient, right? So the sort of takeaway that I can take when it comes to Yinsen is, again, you know, Yinsen as a company, they are very resilient against oil price fluctuation. And this is definitely because the income, which is exactly why we are talking, that the business model is, understanding the business model is very important. And basically for Yinsen's case, the income that Yinsen is having on basically their current projects, it is not really linked to oil price, right? I mean, oil price will affect, for instance, new projects that is available for them to bid. But it doesn't affect the cash flow, right? Because how does Yinsen makes their revenue? Yinsen makes their revenue via this thing, which is called a charter contract, which is basically fixed upon a contract win, right? Yeah, for sure, there could be some sort of clause that is inserted to penalize them for downtime. But again, if you have seen Yinsen's annual report, they are always 99%, you know, there is 1% of downtime. Yeah. So, correct. So in terms of maybe some fluctuations on the net income and all that, is it could be due to Forex reasons, for instance, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And basically, it's not a very, very complex revenue to understand and to grasp. Yeah. Because, you know, it's just basically your daily charter rate.
Correct.
Right. And that is, and maybe sometimes you do some O&M, which is actually inflation adjusted as well. But the daily charter rate, I mean, the bare boat is the bare boat is actually a straight line in terms of revenue recognition.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. So the conclusion that I'm trying to say is that for Yinsen sort of like business, for an FPSO business, it is actually quite resilient against oil price fluctuation. Maybe you go to the next slide for a bit, John.
Yeah, this one.
Yeah. So, you know, like, again, when we're trying to understand business models, one of the sort of like common complaints with regards to Yinsen, I'm not sure if the same could be said on Armada and MISC, but one of the sort of common complaints on FPSO businesses is that they have high debt, right?
Yeah.
But again, you know, high debt is actually a characteristic that is already inborn and implanted in businesses like, such as this. And it is not necessarily bad because, after all, an FPSO is a high-intensive and high-capex business after all, you know? Capital-intensive business. So what you perhaps need to look beyond the high debt. Of course, you need to understand how the high debt plays. But I mean, just come to think about it, Yinsen have always mentioned, and they always sort of like give this sort of ratio. I don't know. I think it's a little bit too small here. But it's basically
the non-recourse, is it?
It's called the adjusted net debt, lah. Adjusted
yeah.
net leverage.
Oh, yeah, this one.
Yeah. So, just think about this in the sense that okay, it's basically like a debt to EBITDA. Like how much is your debt to your EBITDA on an annual basis, right? And I think is for instance case, it's about 2 to 3 times. So what he's trying to say is that this is a 3 years debt to EBITDA, but you need to remember that for instance case that there is going to be 20 years worth of cash flow. So if 3 years debt to EBITDA, it might not be something that you should be worried about, lah, right?
Yeah.
Because after all, an FPSO, again, as I mentioned earlier, it's a capital-intensive business and you go into a contract at roughly most of the time, it's like 20% equity and 80% debt. You can actually imagine them like basically like a toll road operator, you know?
Correct.
Yeah, and I mean... I can go on and on talking about Yinsen.
That's why I'm holding my mouth shut. Because I know I'm going to start, cannot stop already.
But, you know, maybe, I mean, just one last thing about Yinsen is, and their business model, right? Because we don't really want to talk about their financials and stuff like that. But in terms of their business model and why, I think they're quite an impressive company in a sense that, you know, John and I, we had the privilege to talk to CY, and he actually mentioned to us that, you know, in FPSO business, the term value is not just created from contract wins. Of course, that Correct. Is definitely one method lah. But value is also created by completing projects on time and on budget, which so far Yinsen have been doing. Right. So he shared basically, I think, if I'm not mistaken, a classic example on one of his FPSO, I think it's the Jack, JK, right?
Yeah,
the Kufor, right? Where they won the contract already and they managed to deliver the project on time. And then after that, they actually sold down, I think, 26% of the 25. Equity of 35% of the equity 25, of Jack.
25, yeah.
For about $120 million, okay? And this is basically, you're selling 26% for $120 million for something that they invested for about $200 million in, and of which the capital was only $80 million, right?
Correct.
And I think subsequently, they managed to sort of like refinance and they took back another $200 million. So it was like, they have taken back about $400 million from the project with $200 million investment. And on top of that, they are still owning 76% of the project.
All
right. So it's, I mean, as a financial guy, right, when I think about it, it's just like, it's very, very interesting, you know, like how they managed to be able to do this. When we talk about this term in investment term, which is return on capital, return on investment, capital, invested capital, right? I believe Yinsen is one of a very, very interesting case study to look into.
Yep, certainly. No disagreement with you. Actually, the term they like to use, Rondi, is capital recycling.
Capital recycling. Yeah.
Capital recycling. How efficient you are at capital recycling. Move on to anything else, Rondi, before I move on?
Nope. Yep. Okay. That's a little bit about Yinsen.
Okay. So I think Siu here is quite familiar. She's he or she said his FPSO biz model is from bareboat, charter, O&M and EPC. Yinsen, most of Yinsen's contract, except for I think Biendong, is actually bareboat. The rest are all time charters, if I recall correctly. Most of it are actually on time charters. That means they supply the crew as well as they will do all the maintenance uptime, right? So the next one is actually a mobile offshore production unit. So it looks like a jack-up rig. And what happens is that these are used in slightly shallow waters compared to an FPSO. This is actually in replacement of a production facility. You need to get it up and running fast. And they actually have the full-fledged flare, production separation, all these kind of things. The players that are actually playing in this space are Petra, T7 Global, and T7 Global used to be known as Tanjong Offshore and MISC. So as you can see, because it's not that big, the storage sometimes needs to be shuttled to a shuttle tanker like this, like a VLCC carrier or a Suezmax carrier to shuttle this crude actually back to shore. Yeah, because most of the time when you deploy this very fast, the reason why you deploy a MOPU is because you do not have the pipeline, you do not have a facility you can tie back where you can export the thing over to... JJ is there. Thank you, JJ. Lamson and Biendong. Bareboat. Yeah. So the reason why you have a MOPU up and running that fast is because you don't have existing facilities nearby that you actually can tie back into a pipeline, and that's why you need a shuttle tanker to be there on standby. Okay. So the next segment we talk about is actually offshore support services, or OSS. So these are the guys like your Icon Offshore, Alam Maritime. I'm pretty sure if you have invested in the oil and gas industry before, you've definitely heard of this name. Perisai, Yinsen. Actually, Yinsen, before they ventured into the FPSO, they actually started out. Yeah, they actually started out with the offshore support service vessels leasing. Sapura is in it. Petra is also in it. Perdana Petroleum, Icon, and Coastal Contracts. So I want to get to the juicy part as fast as possible. So you know, you guys can look at the slide and read the definitions. I won't go through and explain all this. So the OSV, SSV, virtually is a boat that functions differently for different purposes. That's it. Okay. Topside major maintenance. Now this one, if you guys are on i3, I'm pretty sure you see, I'm not going to name names, but I think Rondi knows exactly who I'm talking about. People who actually write about players within this space and use very simple valuation metrics like a PE or price to book, and then, you know, but doesn't go in to explain the business model of these players. So what does a topside major maintenance and a hookup commissioning contractor? So you will see this very often if you read any oil and gas player reports, TMM, HUC, okay? So what they do is this. So if you think of this is your house. Your house, for you, you know, Chinese New Year, Hari Raya, Deepavali, or whatever celebration, you actually do what we call major cleaning, spring cleaning. So let's just say your aircon rosak, your kipas rosak, your fan rosak, all this equipment, but even more complex equipment that is on an offshore facility. So you need to call in guys, serious guys with specialty skills, with the right equipment to actually maintain and to repair all this non-working process equipment on your platform. And this is why you have this term called topside major maintenance. What they do is this. let's just say you have a platform. It's very cramped, guys. There's very little space on the platform. You know, you wanna. It's not like your house where you can put a store and you can store your car tang one. You know, this in a platform is literally, if you don't have a space, you ship it back to shore. And the reason why you actually need this additional, so what they do is the topside major maintenance contractor, they actually bring in a boat. So this is like a floating hotel. Like this is a Perdana Emerald. Perdana Emerald, somewhere between 300 to 400 pax. You can't hear, is it? Hello. No, Ronnie, no. Can you hear me?
Can. Go.
Okay. Yeah, I think my AirPods just died. I'm just going to go into my...
No. I can hear you well. Now I cannot hear you, John. Go back to what you were doing. Now you're on mute. You need to unmute yourself. I think...
Okay, can you hear me
now? Yeah,
now
it's good. Yep.
Okay, all right. So sorry about that. So Petra Emerald, what they do is you actually, it's like a floating hotel. There's actually a big deck where you bring in your spare parts, your maintenance equipment, and you actually house all the, you actually have to house all these workers, the welders, the technicians, to be able to perform the work on the platform. And where these guys have an advantage, Dayang, Petra, Perdana Petroleum, they actually have these vessels, these assets on standby, and they are usually awarded what we call a TMM, Topside Major Maintenance Contract, for usually it's a 5+5 year contract, Rondi. Oh, you know, sorry, five year with an extension of 1 year. So that means within those 5 years, all the PSC players, let's say Shell, Nippon, Exxon, whoever that has a platform in Malaysia, it's actually a pan-Malaysian contract where they can just call out, hey, if Dayang is the winner of the contract, hey, Dayang, I need you to do maintenance on platform A, B, and C over this period of time. They'll give you the work scope. And this way, in a way, is somewhat of a stable cash flow for the company during that 5 years. Because once you're awarded, that means there's some utilization rate for your vessel, some utilization rate for your manpower resources to actually maintain these platforms. Okay. Yeah. Specialized machinery and maintenance services. These are the, you know, niche player, very, very niche. You guys got Delium. You know, I think 2 weeks ago we did a, was it this week or last week? I can't remember, Randy. That we did a video on them on the bribery case. But that was actually their offshore services. But I'm referring to Delium in this particular regard to their turbine machinery.
Yep.
So they actually have some sort of a monopolistic arrangement where all the Malaysian, all the PSC players in Malaysia, to buy a gas turbine, power like a generation gas turbine of a certain size, we actually have to go through Delium. And because they actually have this kind of sole source agreement, they also have maintenance contracts on them. So any one of those platforms that actually have it's actually called a solar turbine.
Yep.
It's actually governed under this thing called a gas framework, GFA agreement, gas framework agreement, where all these PSC players will actually have to buy from them. And they, because of that, they secure the maintenance for many, many years to come as well. Yeah, so Turbo Mac, Frontcan. Now, Frontcan is very special in this place is because let's just say your rotating equipment actually wears down. They are actually specialized in refurbishing those rotating equipment back to, not to say back to 100% the original state, but prolonging the life of this equipment. They have the specialized services to do that. K&M, I think recently, I don't know if you follow the news, Rondi, their request for rights or private placement got shot down, you know, in the AGM.
I saw.
Yeah. So they actually do pressurized vessels. So you can see one of their equipment here. Okay. So next is the pipe coating steel fabricators. I won't go into too much detail because these are more towards steel works. I think Rondi and I, we've discussed this. They are sub-niche providers to the bigger players within the industry. The steel works, the pipes, the valves, the flanges.
Yeah.
So, okay. midstream, finally, we've done with upstream. And it's coming to 10:30. All right. So midstream, I would say there's only a few players midstream, very, very focused. So midstream, you can divide them into, I would generally categorize them into two categories. One is called EPCC, midstream contractor. So Dialog, what do they do? Is they actually build storage farms for themselves and also for other clients around the world. So if I'm not mistaken, they recently got a contract in Australia to do an EPCC work. They actually do repairs for downstream refineries, midstream storage facilities as well. They have other specialized services, but the big chunk of their revenue actually comes from their EPCC work and also their asset operator. So what do they do, Randy, is this. They actually develop tank terminal facilities where the users are actually people who trade oil. So you think of it. So you've got an upstream operator like Hibiscus, right? Hibiscus doesn't sell directly to a refiner, you know. Sometimes they do. Maybe in the UK, like they sell directly to BP, but it's also not a refiner. It's actually a trader or oil trader. There's an oil trader. And in this case, one of the biggest clients for Dialog is Transfigura. I hope I pronounce it correct. Transfigura. Mm-hmm. What they do, Transfigura rents this space and they actually become the trader to match the buyer and the seller of crude oil. So they'll buy from Hibiscus, for example. They'll store the oil in these tank facilities. And then they could probably sell to a downstream refinery like Hengyan or like Petron or Saudi Aramco in Saudi Arabia. So Transfigura is the guy who does all this trading and they need storage facilities for this. So Dialog's business model, it doesn't really care about the oil price sensitivity.
Correct.
Trafigura. Yeah, I knew I pronounced it wrongly. So... So what Dialog's revenue model is really pretty simple. I build these tanks, whether the oil price is at $100 a barrel or $20 a barrel, you have to pay me rental. So the sensitivity is not a direct correlation again. And this is something that I like about, you know, Dialog's business model. Yeah. Okay. This is the one that I wanted to showcase. A lot of people... who don't like geography actually find this pretty boring, but I find this pretty interesting because now what are all these numbers? Actually, some context for this graph. This is actually the graph of what we call the world oil choke points. So where is the highest demand of oil in the world today? It's actually what we call East. Is it North Asia, countries like China, Japan, Korea? Where's the biggest producer of oil in the world? Is actually in the Gulf States, in the Middle East. And because of that, there's no direct pipe from the Middle East all the way to China. You know, I think they're building one, if I'm not mistaken. But even if they build one, it's not enough to carry the entire capacity. So the only way or the cheapest way is actually to transport it by sea. And because of that, if you see this red number here, Rondi and the rest, this actually represents the amount of oil that is transported through the Straits of Hormuz. It's actually a straits in the Middle East per day. 19 per day, million barrels per day. Yeah. Crazy. I just wanted to... It's insane. It's insane. So, if you guys follow world geopolitical events, you remember there was one time there was a bombing and the US actually sent navies there. They claimed that Iran actually bombed. The reason why that was very hot in the press was because this is actually the biggest shipping route for oil. And the Straits of Malacca, we are not bad. World number two, you know, Randy. between Indonesia and Malaysia. So we can claim both countries, we can claim the glory, okay? Straits of Malacca moves 16 million barrels of oil. Now, why is this all related to any oil and gas company in Malaysia? Now, Dialog has assets in Pengerang and it is at the choke point where there's 16 million barrels of oil moving through the Straits of Malacca every day, right? So I want you to think about it first. Now, Way Dialogue actually, and they're not shy. It's actually shown many times in their annual report or their investor relations deck. They want to model Pengerang similar to Rotterdam Port. So Rotterdam Port as an independent storage has independent storage capacity of about 30 million meter cube. And Europe, it is has a population base of roughly about 400 million. So 30 million meter cube to cater for a population of 400 million, Randy, all right?
Yep.
So Southeast Asia, okay. Obviously, they include India, lah, but if you cut India out, you cut China out, so there's roughly about 1 billion, 1 billion guys here. We only have in Southeast Asia a commercial storage of roughly 14 million meter cube. So which is half of that, but we have population that is... Okay, let's cut out India, let's cut out China. Let's just take Southeast Asia, which is about a billion.
Yeah.
We have 14 million meter cube to serve a population of 1 billion. Rotterdam has 30 million meter cube to serve a population of 400 million. So you guys can do the math. That's where the catalyst is, right? The demand will actually come from this region. You just even if you exclude India, China and Japan, where they have a bigger population base. So another midstream operator, MISC, they recently took 6 new VLEC carriers. So like Yinsen, they have FPSOs, MISC has VLEC, so very large ethane carrier. So these are LNG carriers that transport gas around the world. And at one time, Malaysia was world number 9 in terms of gas export, world number 9. I don't know where they are today. I've lost count of the data since I've left the industry. But we're still quite big, lah. We're still quite big, lah, in the industry. Okay. Okay. Downstream refineries, no surprise. Maybe a brief description of their business model. What they do is they take in crude, they do distillation, and they earn from what we call a crack spread, the spread in between the crude oil prices and the price of the refined product. So, like a Hengyuan refinery, what do? Is they take a crude and they actually refine it into gas oil, they refine it into diesel, they refine it into liquefied petroleum gas, a lot of things, nafta, petrol, jet fuel and all that, and it's actually into our pumps. Petron, in a way, it's slightly different from Hengyuan because Hengyuan's business, listed business, is mainly refinery. But Petron, in this case, it actually mixes refinery plus their downstream business is in the listed entity. That's the biggest difference, actually. So Hengyuan, if you want to buy a pure play refinery, it's Hengyuan. But if you want to buy a mixed play refinery plus a downstream retail business, it's actually Petron. Yeah, correct. I personally don't like refinery business, Randy, because I can give you all the top of my head. Even when Buffett was investing in Phillips 66 in the US, I looked at the numbers. Margins on average is 6-7% net margins. Very, 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 very tight business margins. You have to run the plant very efficiently, and if your plant is very old, it's a struggle to actually produce efficiently, lah. Yeah, but you know, who knows? You guys may be refinery experts that you can can see things that I don't see, lah. Okay, downstream retail, only two guys: Petronas Dagangan and Petron. As I explained, Petron earlier, Dagangan is mainly the retail arm and the commercial arm. Okay, petrochemicals, two players only: Petronas Chemicals and Lotte. I'm rushing through here because I feel that this in itself deserves another session. I'm definitely no petrochemicals expert. I spent my entire life in upstream. But from what I know as an investor in Petronas Chemicals, I like their margins. It's 30% margins during good times. I think during bad times it's about 20%. Because the value add for petrochemicals is much higher than just a pure refiner. Because what you can sell is the aromatics to the perfume industry. You sell to the polyethylene to the plastics industry. You sell urea fertilizer and all that. It actually has a higher value in terms of selling. That's the reason why petrochemicals, the value add is much higher, the value chain as well.
Yeah. Sorry, John. Yeah, before that, I actually saw a question just now. I cannot remember. I think it was from Wei Xiang. I cannot scroll up anymore. It's too much already, right? But he actually mentioned about the negative correlation of price from the downstream petrochemical guys and oil price. I think because he believes that, as we all know, even for instance, like a Lotte Chemical, one of their sort of cost structure and the feed, their feed is basically naphtha, and naphtha is correct. Derived from oil, right? Maybe John, what's your opinion about that? Does the oil price becomes their cost and therefore it is actually negatively correlated with regards to their financials?
Ironically, that was what I thought in the past as well, Rondi. Mm-hmm. And I got corrected when I checked with industry insiders, because the negative correlation is temporary only. So what I mean by that? So for the context of everyone who are trying to understand this, Wei Kai was asking about this negative correlation, that means if, let's just say, crude oil prices is at $20 a barrel, wouldn't the petrochemicals or the refineries rejoice because their raw material price has gone down so much? Correct. Mm. Because you can sell your, let's say you sell your raw 95, raw 97 at, let's say, I'm just giving an example, let's say $40 for a liter, $40 a barrel, and then your cost is at 20, right?
Yeah.
The problem is this. The price of the refined product or the petrochemical actually correlates with the crude. That means when you are actually buying these petrochemicals, if your crude price for that quarter is actually 20, during that quarter, you can enjoy the spread. But subsequent quarter, whatever byproduct or petrochemical that the plant produced, that price is actually correlated to crude oil price.
Mm-hmm.
So that means you enjoy only a short period of this negative correlation. But then after equilibrium, it actually correlates again.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's actually, I've seen a graph by McKinsey before. After I checked with my friends in petrochemical, I went to check on the graph of some studies done by McKinsey. Yeah, it's actually usually 1 quarter to 6 months. Then the price will correlate again.
Yep.
Yeah.
So okay. At the end of the day, for that particular, the answer for that, you know, Wei Xiang, it's really related to, it's one is cost, but the average selling price is also being derived from the cost as well. So you need, especially on Lotte Chemical, I believe you need to really look into the spread between naphtha and polyethylene.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And polyethylene has a mind of its own. The price spread. So.
Yeah. So, you know, maybe... So I would like to come back again on this particular poll that we saw earlier. And hopefully by now we can understand a little bit more about the relationship between actually the price of oil and the oil companies in Malaysia, right? Honestly, when I first checked with some of my friends in the institutional, some of the institutional guys, I asked the same question, right? A lot of them actually came to me and says that the reason why Malaysian oil and gas counters in terms of share price are lackluster and there is a lack of interest is mainly due to ESG issues. And I would say the second one they look into is basically they believe that the Petronas capex pattern is a concern going forward. I think over here, this is basically at the H piece where Petronas mentioned that, you know, they are going to spend $45 billion in capex over the next 5 years. But what is important over here is that the percentage of capex that is being utilized for renewable energy had actually increased from 5% to 9%. So that sort of like, I believe, exemplifies on what is going to be the future trend, right? And the future trend is just basically there is going to be a more shift towards renewable energy. And we have definitely seen a lot of the companies. I believe all the companies that we covered today, there is also a greater emphasis on every time they talk to investors on ESG, right? RL, Reservoir Link, and Yinsen, they had both moved into the renewable energy space. Yinsen had moved into the green tech space even. And Rondi, sorry.
Yeah. Suddenly my mic just died. I can't hear you. just go ahead and explain.
Okay. Yeah. Can everybody else hear me? John, can you hear me?
Let me try again. Just go ahead and explain, don't worry. Let me sort this out first.
Okay. So yeah, that's basically that, you know. We have seen Yinsen and RL moving into the renewable energy space. And when we talked to Hibiscus, I think a few weeks ago, there is a big emphasis on ESG and how they're going to be carbon neutral, or even some of them are talking about zero carbon and stuff like that. And that's going to be the future trend. So yeah, and when it comes to the lackluster of the share price performance in Malaysia, definitely ESG is one, because from what I understand is, you know, there are some foreign funds which are mandated that they cannot touch oil and gas stocks. So that's an issue that everybody need to be aware about. John, can you move to the next slide? Okay, John cannot hear me. Okay, but you know, just if let's say you guys are wondering about what is my personal opinion about this entire thing, about this entire ESG issue, right? I personally am in the camp where, you know, I believe that it is not so easy for all these politicians and regulators who champions ESG to get from step A to step B in, say, a few years' time. It's not going to happen, right? Because, I mean, there is this article recently, I think it's from Financial Times, which is titled as Greenflation. And in the article, it is basically mentioning that whenever we try to transition into all this ESG and climate change at the priority and stuff like that, if we try to transition too quickly, things are going to be expensive. So I'm with John in that I believe that it is quite foolish to expect oil companies to be performing badly in the long term. So I believe that oil companies in the next decade would be similar to like tobacco companies in the past. I'm not sure if all of you are have been invested in or have been an investor, let's just say about 10 to 15 years ago. But 10 to 15 years ago, basically what happened is there is this entire narrative about how tobacco companies is, you know, they're just going to be not relevant anymore. And what happened then is that they have been shunned by a lot of big investors. But, you know, for those investors that actually stayed around, they actually got a fantastic return for about 5 to 10 years after that. Only that I would say in the past, say 3 to 5 years, then that particular prediction that came about 15 years ago came into fruition. So that's where I stand when it comes to investing in the oil and gas sector.
Great. Sorry about the technical fault just now. I don't know what happened. I couldn't get my headsets to work. So I got out and came in again.
Yeah.
So you want me to move the next slide, Rondi?
Yes, please, John.
Yes, sorry about that. Yeah. So this carbon emission, I think this is something. Have you spoken already about this, Rondi?
You need to share your screen, John.
Oh, my goodness. Sorry.
Yeah. So sorry. I was just sharing basically my view on the entire ESG issue on oil and gas counter.
I see. Okay. So yeah, carbon emission, ESG. Yeah, over to you, Ronnie.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I already covered this just now. Okay. But again, just want to emphasize that one of the reason is ESG issue. That is why people are, a lot of investors are concerned about ESG. And there has been like a move, for instance, you know, in a recent UN climate summit, there was an alliance of the world's largest pension funds and insurers. Yeah. which committed itself to transitioning its portfolio to net zero emission by 2050. So oil and gas sector is basically right now under some increasing investor pressure. Activist shareholders, they're challenging this the climate policies and emission reduction plans when it comes to oil and gas players.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. And even a lot of ETF funds also are having an ESG theme as a criteria, actually. So definitely something to watch out for. Lah.
Yep. And when it comes to the next slide, I was just going to touch on something that, again, all oil and gas investors in Malaysia should take a look into. Right. And it's basically on Petronas's CAPEX. Yeah. Petronas had released this publicly available information on their outlook from 2021 to 2023. I'm just sharing a few of the charts here. I think I mentioned on the decommissioning earlier on ARA, but these are the rest of it. You know, they look into the outlooks on number of rigs, number of man hours, and number of vessels to do drillings, and number of vessels supporting productions and everything. I mean, everybody can sort of like look into the charts and come up with their own conclusions. Although I would again reiterate what John earlier mentioned earlier, in that there are sort of like I would say spots where you can still invest in some of these names in the the services, in the oil services sector in Malaysia, lah.
Precisely. Yeah. Precisely. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to wrap it up, and then we're going to open the floor to Q&A, because there's a lot of Q&A. We'll try our best to respond to most of it, but I doubt we can respond to everyone, Rondi. So yeah, it's a lot. So the conclusion is this: not all oil and gas companies actually correspond directly to oil prices. I think Rondi has quite clearly shown, I've also quite clearly shown, some of these business models are not directly correlated. So it's important to understand the nature of the revenue model for each company. And more importantly is to understand the risks and probabilities of each. Because you see, it's not just about projecting a future cash flow or future profit, but it's also about understanding risks and probabilities. Because in the oil and gas industry, there's many, many variables that can wreak havoc. You know, one deep water horizon is enough to wreak havoc on a lot of things. So, you know, size your bets accordingly, understand the risks and probabilities before you actually, invest. Not everyone makes the same margin. I've mentioned this many, many times before. If you see any oil and gas players making sustainable, not 1 year, but many, many years of good margins, that means they have some kind of a pricing power. Mm-hmm. And those are the kinds of companies that I try to, you know, keep awake on, keep a tap on, right? I think, you know, since JJ is also here, Rondi, he's, I think I'm going to, it's not him who said it only, many, many guys actually say this. In the oil and gas business, it's really a big boys game. If you're small, right? Maybe RL, yes, because it's very niche. You know, you don't need a lot of capex. But if you want to play the FPSO game, you want to play the, you know, the oil storage game, you want to play the asset game, you really, really need the proper financing and backing. And it's a really a big boys game. And last but not least, I think this one, you definitely wouldn't disagree with me. Quality of management and shareholder alignment is very key. So I don't have the numbers to crunch. I actually crunched the numbers, but I don't have it in a chart here. What I notice, correlation, and this is a strong hint. If you see owners of the oil and gas companies over a long period of time, they are majority owners, and you correspond that to shareholder return versus listed companies that had outside hires against their return to shareholders, you can see quite a strong correlation. I think, Rondi, you understand what I'm trying to say, right? It's a bit cryptic, but I think rather than saying it out loud, just look at shareholder alignment, how much skin they have in the game, and then you also see quality of management. You can see the difference to shareholder returns. So I think if there's nothing else to add, Rondi, should we open the floor to questions?
Yeah, we should. Guys, so just you know, shoot some questions. There has been a lot of questions on top, John.
We can't scroll up.
We can't scroll up anymore.
Yeah.
But I think there was one very, very interesting question, right? And it's, I don't exactly remember how the question came about, but
yeah.
It's a lot to do with valuations and how to value oil and gas company. Yeah, I think we definitely need to touch on that. Maybe let me start first.
Sure.
So I think, you know, just now, John mentioned about when he spoke about Dayang and how there was a, I would say like supposedly to be a popular investor or something like that, right? Who simply uses like PE ratio. And I personally don't think that PE ratio can easily be the go-to method when it comes to valuing oil and gas companies. So let me just give you guys like maybe one or two scenarios, right? So for instance, if let's say we would like to value a company like Hibiscus, but let's just assume that Hibiscus will only own like, instead of owning whatever that they have owned at the moment, but perhaps they only own, say, like one oil field, and that this oil field is, let's just say that it is closing towards the end of its life cycle. Maybe it has another 3 years to go, right? So you can't just simply use like PE ratio and say that, oh, this company is trading at a PE of 5 times, and say, if I look into how its peers globally is trading at, or historically it's trading at a certain level of PE, and therefore I think that it's undervalued. I don't think that serves justice to yourself, because you will understand that there is only a balance of 3 years left before the end of the life cycle of that particular oil well, and then they definitely have no more income. They have no more revenue. So this is exactly I suppose the point on first understanding the business. How is the business operate, and then try and look at what sort of valuation methodology that is the most appropriate to use into that particular business model.
Yeah. I would add on to that, Rondi. I think you gave a very good example about using Hibiscus. I like to use Dayang, in which this famous investor actually uses a model. So can you imagine? It's at the tail end of the 5-year topside major maintenance contract, tail end, and they just finished that particular contract. So for the next year, let's just say there was if they use trailing PE, you would see if there's market sentiment, they know they've already come to the tail end, right? People will start dumping the share, and then you see declines in profit because they're at the tail end, they're not getting any revenue. Then all of a sudden, they won the contract again. And then at that point, they haven't started generating revenue from the new maintenance contract. How can you use PE as a benchmark? That's the first thing. Second thing is this. If you actually read the revenue recognition from these contracts for Dayang and Dialog, there are actually certain terms and conditions where the revenue is actually recognized. And this goes to show that how much you need to understand the nature of these contracts before you just use a simple valuation metrics, because there are actually clauses that actually will disallow Dayang or Petra or whoever won the contract to be paid, and is actually recognized differently on the balance sheet. Is recognized differently. I'm not going to go, because then I have to explain the contract standards and all. But virtually, if you don't understand the business and you apply just a simple metrics, then that's where I think you're really kidding yourselves. The next example I like to give is actually Hibiscus. Now, Hibiscus, what I really like is this. You mentioned earlier, Rondi, about how difficult it is to all the permutations and the variables to include the decom costs. And one of the questions I actually asked Deepak, which is I can't remember his title, VP for strategy or something, but he actually gave me a very logical answer about, they actually park roughly about 440 million as their decom cost for their existing asset. This not including their Repsol assets yet, 440, 420 million, right, on the balance sheet. And I asked, is this robust enough? Because it actually fluctuates. As I mentioned earlier, and I think you also mentioned that all this varies with the crude oil prices. So their assumption is that if crude oil prices actually go lower, the decom cost actually would be lower. And that's why in the balance sheet, they think that it is actually a conservative estimate of the decom cost. But if you use PE, right, just a simple PE, trailing PE or even forward PE, it doesn't even take into account all this. Another important thing about Hibiscus businesses is the acquisition cost or the seismic cost to acquire all this. It's actually part on the balance sheet, you see. And if you just use a simple, even discounted cash flow, you will not catch it. Unless you include all these assumptions and understand how to read their business well. Another one is Yinsen, you know, we could go on and on. Many, many examples. If you just use simple evaluation ratios, I think you fall into the trap of oversimplifying your thesis.
I mean, I love Yinsen as well, right? But it's just that if, let's say, you're doing a PE valuation on just Yinsen, you're doing this service to yourself, because PE doesn't really detect the amount of debt and the amount of leverage, right? So you're totally missing out that particular point, which by right, all investors need to really take a close look into, right?
Yes, exactly. Okay, so I'm trying to scroll up as much as I can to find questions. Does the level of oil... Okay, Michael Owen has a question. It's quite good. It looks rudimentary, but it's a very good question. Does the level of oil thickness affect the selling price? Yes, it does. So remember I mentioned earlier that, you know, African crude is very thick, very viscous. If you pour it from a beaker, certainly it won't even come out. So it actually has a lot of what we call contaminants. So there's a lot of wax. That's why it's very viscous and very thick. And when you refine what we call thick crude, you actually spend more money to refine these products. And that's why this kind of crude, a slightly lower quality crude, is actually sold at a cheaper rate as compared to what you normally see. So you actually see like WTI or Brent, which is two very commonly used standards of crude that are sold in the markets today. But there are various different types of crude. Like for example, Malaysia, our type of crude is actually called, our grade of crude is actually called Tapis crude. And Tapis crude is actually sold at a premium as compared to WTI or Brent, because it's lighter, very low sulfur content, very easy to process, it's sweet. We call it sweet crude. And when you sell, it's actually slightly at a premium to the WTI or to the Brent. Yeah. So yes, it does affect the selling price.
Yeah.
Okay, next.
What about this one, John?
I think you bring it up.
We touched briefly on this.
the executive director is a friend of mine, Wikai. If I were to liken the business, they are something like Dayang or Petra, but they don't have the vessels. So they do a lot of this. They can do maintenance, they can do hookup work, but because they don't have big assets that are, which is good. It's good in if they don't take debt on it and to build these assets like Dayang or Petra, but it also stops them from taking on big jobs, big TMM jobs, because it's all about track record and about assets. So the reason why Dayang and I worked offshore projects for 10 years, is just cycling between Dayang or Petra only, you know. Every time hookup maintenance, Dayang or Petra. Only these two guys. Yeah. So next one is Perf Was Cement, P&A, Decom.
Okay, James, I have another question.
You bring it up?
Yeah. Are FPSO only used in deep waters? That's not common in Malaysia.
Most of the time, yes. Most of the time, yes. Because shallow water assets, especially those steel structures and jackets, are much easier to build, much cheaper. That's why. Yeah.
Okay. And Ivan is asking, well, a lot of FPSO lovers here. So FPSO doesn't need to have high decom costs, John.
It's a boat, guys. So you don't need to hire something like a Haramar or an overseas vessel to chop and then lift it. You can just sail it into a scrapyard and you scrape it there. So they just need to chop off the subsea tiebacks, the surf lines, and you know, you're ready to go. And then you just plug the well in the subsea. Yet there is a little bit more cost to plug in subsea wells as compared to a topside well. Just a little bit more. But you know, the big cost comes with actually chopping a fixed topside structure and a fixed jacket.
All right.
Yeah.
I think there is not much more questions from what we can see. I mean, I'm so sorry, but if you guys have questions much earlier, we cannot see them anymore.
So sorry. If you want to re-ask them, we can.
Yeah. Maybe there's just, I'll just pull out one or two last questions. This one is asking, I love Armada. Do you think it will make another earnings in the coming quarter? Maybe I'll just try and explain on this first, John. Maybe you can add on. I think in terms of Armada, we have actually seen like recently, you know, the past few years they did struggle. I believe it's because of one of their business units, which they recently I don't know whether they disposed or what, but you know, it was not performing. And right now, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, John, but I think now they are just on an FPSO player, right?
Yeah. Mainly, they also have offshore support vessels business, but it's not a big, it's not as big as the revenue contribution in terms of the FPSO. Yeah.
Okay.
So I think Powerpuff Man, what you
Powerpuff Man.
Yeah, that's how he calls himself. So I have to call him that. While I was researching for Armada, you can actually find their contract on the SEC filing. So if you're a big fan of Armada, I highly suggest that you read the contract and understand it and try to understand the nuance of that contract as compared to the other FPSO players. You know, Rondi and I, we've had the privilege of speaking to CY and JJ, CY's right-hand man. And rather than trying to bash competitors, let's put up matrices that you have to measure FPSO players against. One is, have they had a track record of delivering FPSOs with very high uptime? That's one. Secondly, when they write these contracts, do they actually have proper non-recourse clauses and termination clauses that actually protect the leaser, in which the FPSO leaser? And last but not least, right, I think for me as a technical guy, when you engineer an FPSO, these are highly engineered facilities. One way as an industry outsider to learn better is actually ironically to talk to industry insiders and talk about, hey, if you work on this FPSO versus the other FPSOs, right, how often do you actually shut down suddenly? You can actually get a hint of how well these facilities are designed and maintained, and ironically, this translates to bottom line. Yeah, there are many other factors, but I would say these are the main ones. Non-recourse, your contract termination clauses, your ability to borrow. And if you can see that your ability to borrow, there's a lot of people willing to take on the debt and give you debt to actually finance the project, that also gives you an indication of how well an FPSO company is being run. Yeah, that's how I would add on.
Yep.
I'm at the bottom. John Chai asked about this question about, let me see. Oh, okay. James asked about Petronas Gas and Gas Malaysia. I've not studied them too much, so I can't give you a concrete opinion. But what I can say is that because they have a monopoly, I think that is an advantage to them. If you go and see the gas grid over in Sarawak, actually in Miri, all our landed houses are actually piped gas. We don't actually normally have cylindrical gas. And once you have, I think in Terengganu or Kelantan, you may have piped gas near Gebeng or Kreteh. I'm not too sure. I've not been there. But once you have a gas grid network, that's where you can really see the proliferation of its use. Now, why I'm giving you an example, if you go to temperate countries like Japan or Korea, gas is very heavily relied for as a heating source. That's why you see when there are very cold winters, especially in Northern Europe, you see gas prices shoot through the roof. In Malaysia, we don't have very predominant use of gas for heating. Therefore, a lot of it is used for industry uses to produce petrochemicals, to actually produce chemical byproducts and all that, or probably electricity generation rather than for heating. So if they can find a good use case for all this pipe gas, That's where I think Petronas Gas and Gas Malaysia can actually enjoy that benefits. Yeah, I hope I answered that question clearly to you. Oil bunkering, Van Hammer, I don't really have an opinion about it, to be honest. Next one I saw was actually John Chai asking about Semchem. You have any idea? I'm not studied this company too well, Rondi, Semchem.
Yeah, I haven't studied it too well. I mean, I know that the result came out today and it's a fantastic result. John, if I can just lead you to Stockbit, you know, there is this person. His name is Tan Peng Lam.
Peng Lam.
Him. Yeah.
Yeah.
He is an investor in Semchem. Yeah, do follow him and he can help you perhaps shape some sort of ideas on this company.
Correct. Peng Lam is a voice I listen to, a very, very, very thoughtful, well thought through investor. Peng Lam.
Yeah. But definitely it's a good result today. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's for sure. Yeah. It's a record quarter and record revenue, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Price jump already,
just released today.
I see. Okay. MC, okay. I think we'll take this last one, last two, then we call it a day. It's 11 already.
Sure.
Yeah. So Daniel Loh asks, how does MCO affecting all these offshore services? Yeah, actually, you know, so funny that you ask, and I don't know whether JJ is still around. You know, so when Rondi and I had the privilege to speak to both JJ and CY, they actually said that they chartered private jets for their crew. I nearly fell off my chair. I'm like, but in unprecedented times, takes unprecedented steps. I think by hook or by crook, life has to go on. It's definitely impacted. Hibiscus is also very severely impacted. I have friends, ex-colleagues in Shell. It's tough because, can you imagine, it's usually a roster of 2 weeks onshore, 2 weeks offshore. But when you're 2 weeks onshore, you actually can't go back to your family because you want to be in a bubble. So they actually they chuck you into a hotel. So then 2 weeks again, you have to go out offshore. So literally, you don't get to see your family. So it's definitely impacted. But I think the oil and gas industry has ways and means to try to, you know, try to adapt to it. Yeah. Last one. When will Repsol acquisition benefit Hibiscus production? If I'm not mistaken, I saw Andrew Fernandez in the chat, Rondi. So I don't know whether Andrew wants to answer on behalf of Repsol.
But yeah, I mean, on Repsol, you know, again, you guys can go back to the presentation that was done by Ming Tech and John. I think that was a very, very good presentation. Actually, Dr. Kenneth did show that particular EBITDA, the EBITDA that they're going to earn from just the Repsol. Once they have Repsol in. And I don't remember
the timeline actually, Rondi. That's why I was hoping to, rather than give them an answer that I was unsure. There Andrew said, check out the website. Yeah, on the front page. So you go to Hibiscus website, Sui Cheng is actually on the front page. So some of the materials I actually got from that slide. You guys can see that from there.
But just again, this one is out of the presentation slide from the investor briefing a few weeks ago. An estimated Repsol asset contribution to EBITDA would be an additional 558.8 million in calendar year 2022. And that is basically on top of, say, the current Hibiscus EBITDA, which is around 250 million, right?
Yeah.
So if, let's say, you just add them both together and look into what's the current sort of market cap of Hibiscus, you can always sort of come up with your own conclusions, I would say.
Yeah.
But again, on Hibiscus, hopefully what we delivered to you today is that it is very, very much linked to the oil price. But again, if, let's say, coming back to a presentation earlier, their cost of production is again very low, you know.
Correct.
So
correct.
Just take those things into account.
Okay, Rondi, I think we'll wrap up for tonight. And you know, thank you all for participating. I think at the peak we had about 230 Right now they still are 180. It's 11, you know, if you guys have to work tomorrow, so you know. Rondi was saying, hey, let's try to keep it within 2 hours. Yeah.
Yeah,
but anyway, we're happy to do it, right, Rondi, for you guys.
Yep,
and
for sure.
Yeah so hope to catch you guys in the next session. And Rondi, any last words?
You know, if you guys can definitely catch John in Stockbit as well, you can chat with both John or MJ in Stockbit. If let's say you guys have any queries to them, then do drop by and take a visit. Other than that, you know, hopefully the presentation had delivered what we mentioned we wish to deliver in the beginning of the session. Other than that, yeah, I think that's all. That's all, John, from me. Thanks, all right. Thanks to you for the presentation. I mean, I'm just here chilling and learning from you the entire time, you know. So it's been a good session for me, lah. Educational, very educational.
We all learn together, lah, Rondi. Thank you so much. Yeah. All right. Hey, good night, guys. Stay safe.
Good night.
Hope you guys get your second jab, and you know, please stay safe.
Yes. Good night. Thank you, bye-bye, guys. Bye.